The James H. Reeve phone in.
There's many a time I've sat in my living room and cried my eyes out because of these tattoos. I've even thought of getting a knife and cutting them off myself.
Call now on 0161 288 0103.
So, do you think they're going to cost an arm and an egg?
An arm and an egg!
Call now on 0161 288 0103.
What they don't seem to realise is that respect on the street is not respect, it's fear.
Call now on 0161 288 0103.
I'm entitled to walk in my community safe and live in my own home safe. But they took that away from us.
The James H. Reeve phone in on key 103. Call now on 0161 288 0103.
And welcome to what we can only describe as What Is the World Coming To edition of James H. Reeve on Key 103. Where should we start tonight? Well, we won't... I'll tell you, we will do later, we will allude to this Noel Edmonds tripe, because I know that you do like a little bit of frivolity amongst it all, and the baffling thing is, can nobody see what's going on there? Am I the only one? Or is that just another symptom of the bit of a condition that I've got? Anyway, later on. Not right now, because I don't really know where to start here. As I was just saying to that Deborah woman, not only have we got, well, we've got it all here. It's local. It's got knives in it. Yes, it's, what is it? Is it a kitchen showroom? No, it's not. It's a very serious matter about school in Blakely. And a kid thrown out, I'm afraid we're not allowed to use that word anymore. It may infringe his human rights. Kid excluded for possessing a knife and had also been guilty of violent conduct on a previous occasion. Now the kid's back in school as a result of an appeal. It's a process of long standing, and it enables the decision of a head teacher to be overturned with all the humiliation that involves. Graham Stringer, MP for the constituency in which the school is situated, raised the matter with the Prime Minister in the House of Commons, and the Prime Minister duly expressed his puzzlement. We'll be talking to Graham Stringer about it shortly. If you live in the area, or you don't have to live in the area if you don't want, if you feel that this is yet another example of people getting their priorities wrong, the rights of malefactors being respected above those of the perfectly ordinary Herbert. 0161 288 0103. The case which in many ways is, well, it's probably the ghastliest thing. I don't even know how you would go about doing this, but you'll be aware of the couple who were both involved in the rape of a child who had been left in their care. This child was 3 months old. Now, I suppose comparisons with Brady and Hindley spring to mind when you look at the details of the case, but anyway, the point is this. The man in question was sentenced to life imprisonment with the option of parole. This is the important thing. The option doesn't mean to say you'll get it, but the option of parole after 6 years. It was pointed out that this might be considered somewhat lenient, and therefore today the law lords have agreed and have said no, he can't be eligible for parole until after 8 years. Well, that's virtually been Alcatraz, isn't it? 0161 288 0103. At the other end of the scale, gentleman fined £75 for feeding pigeons. His kid, what 18 month old?
Yeah.
Throwing chips for the pigeons to eat. Fined on the spot £75. Not the first case of this nature that we've had here. But I think the opposite ends of the spectrum of justice are very interesting. However, salvation is at hand, because the Shadow Home Secretary, David Davis, as this quite often happens, when something happens to a politician, suddenly something's got to be done about it. There have been a few examples of this over the years. Anyway, David Davis got burgled. He now believes, and I think I've shown this in the past, that where James H. Reeve and Key 103 lead, others follow. You might remember a couple of weeks ago I suggested it would be a nice idea if every reasonable person were issued with a death ray. And I did send a memo to our engineering department asking them could they look into the, do a feasibility study on it. But David Davis has actually, he's been swept along with the idea now, and he suggests that every self-respecting person, every law-abiding citizen, should have a taser gun, right, which puts 5,000 volts through your body, produces uncontrollable muscle spasms, and anyone, any ratepayer, should be entitled to have one in the house. What a brilliant idea. Actually, they did do some in America, wasn't it? A town where they gave everybody in the town a gun. And they were rather an interesting experiment. And they were delighted to notice that the following day, the crime rate practically disappeared. It's an interesting concept. But that's what David Davis said. Anyway, if you're confronted with a burglar, just never mind all this argument about whether you used excessive force and all the rest of it. If you've got a gun which can put 5,000 volts through him and render him incapable of burgling, then the world would be a much better place. And he suggests that, I don't know, perhaps you'll get one issued with you when you go and collect your identity card. It seems to me a perfect system. 0161 288 0103. We're here till 1 o'clock. Now, I've already had a number of messages saying, aren't you going to talk about the World Cup? Well, no, because, you know, it is... Surely everybody's talking about the World Cup. Can't this be a little haven where we don't talk about it? In any event, by the time we resume on Sunday evening, we'll be already at the stage where, well, you know, perhaps England... If England can win the next one after the disappointing draw against Paraguay, then we've got a very good chance. So we've got that, so let's keep that one up our sleeve, shall we? But there is an important thing. There's a place in Salford where everyone has been told not to celebrate the World Cup, not to go over the top when they're celebrating any success which England might have. Chance would be a fine thing, but yeah, I think Lower Broughton. I'll tell you that when I can find it, because I seem to have mislaid it. Anyway, there we are. We spread those before you this evening, right? 0161 288 0103. It is also, we have also, there's a birthday on the premises. And I'm afraid I'm going to have to say some rather strong words about that. Anyway, we'll cross that bridge when we come to it. 0161 288 0103. You know what to do. 0161 288 0103. It's just a flick of a finger and you can share your views with the North West. And indeed, I think the service is somewhat restricted now for copyright reasons, but with certain outposts of the Empire. 0161 288 0103. We'll look into this schools business in a second. It's 13 minutes past 10. You're listening to, what is it, the biggest phone in the North West, I understand, on Key 103. Here we go.
Key 103.
Call at 25. £25,000!
I love Key 103!
If that sounds good to you, then the great news is we're doing it again. And this time round, there's even more money to be won. These are the three songs you're listening out for on Key 103's £25,000 triple play. Song 1, Sugar Babes, Push the Button. Song 2, Madonna, Like a Prayer. Song 3, Stereophonics, Handbags and Glad Rags. We will play those songs in full and in that order on Key 103 sometime soon. And when we do, we'll be giving away another £25,000 cash. Stay listening to win cash. The £25,000 triple play is playing again on Manchester's number one hit music station, Key 103.
You're just three steps from the perfect weekend. The Foster's 5 o'clock whistle. Step one, log on to key103.co.uk. Step two, email Digi. Step three, tell him your five biggest weekend anthems. These simple steps could win you a crate of Foster's to kick off the weekend in style. Entrance must be 18 and over.
Thank Foster's, it's Friday.
I need a miracle. On Key 103.
Okay, give me the results.
Tractor production, down. Beetroot yield, down. Cabbage...
Enough! Why are they so lazy?
We suspect Monarch's revolutionary bargain hunter service, sir.
Ah, yes. Where you can find all their cheapest fares. Not that I would use such a decadent service.
Oh, of course not, sir. Nor enjoy the extras like allocated seating and free newspapers.
What? The salt mines need more people, you know.
Bargain hunt your breaks at flymonarch.com.
There's broadband and there's broadband. And I don't want basic broadband. I want quality broadband. I want blue chip 18 karat corner office broadband. Hallmarked broadband. I want silk lined hand stitched Savile Row broadband. I want penthouse with views of the park and a jacuzzi broadband. Belgian chocolate broadband. I want broadband I can introduce to my parents. Solid mahogany aristocratic broadband. I want the Duke of broadband. I want Waxfield, Premier Crew, Swiss Watch broadband.
With BT, you get more than just the basics. With our ultra-reliable, best-ever broadband package, call 0800 032 7939. Subject to availability and survey, BT line required, conditions apply.
The James H. Reid phone-in on Key 103. Call now on 0161 288 0103.
Right, you are. OK, the story, I'll just canter through it again. A pupil at a school in Blakely expelled. Excluded. Because he was carrying a knife. Seems to me to be a perfectly reasonable thing to do. However, reinstated after an appeals panel overturned the expulsion order, the exclusion. And this matter was raised in the House of Commons by Graham Stringer, Labour MP for Blakely, and he joins us now on Key 103. Good evening, Graham.
Evening, Jim.
James, come along now.
Good evening, James.
Thank you. That's better. So, right, you mentioned this to the PM, did you?
Yes, I'd had a distressing letter off the head teacher from this school, who believed that there should be a zero tolerance policy to knives in the school. The boy had been excluded, and then rather poignantly, on the day that the young footballer was murdered with a knife. Yeah. In North London, the Independent Appeals Panel reinstated this boy, so he dashed off a letter to me, sort of expressing his dismay, really, and said he would like me to bring this matter up at the highest levels. And the Prime Minister is about the highest level you can get to, so I did that on Wednesday.
And he expressed his puzzlement, and he agreed with his honourable friend, presumably.
Well, I'd not given him any warning of the question, and he basically said that this seems a strange and unreasonable decision. Those weren't his exact words, but that's what he conveyed. And he said he would look into both the specific case and the general issue of what these independent panels are up to. I mean, I don't know who the members of these panels are. They're put there for a perfectly reasonable purpose, that if head teachers get it wrong, that parents and the pupil have a right to appeal to them, so there is a second view taken on any serious decision like that. But there comes a point where if a head teacher says, you know, the safety of other pupils is at risk because this boy is bringing a knife into school, then he should be supported. In fact, the appeals panel said he'd got the decision right. But
they said what?
Just let me finish, Jim. Sorry, James. They said he'd got the decision right, but because, first of all, in the interest of the school and the boy concerned, he'd tried what was a managed move, i.e. he'd not gone through the technical process of excluding him. He'd tried to get a voluntary agreement for him to go to another school. And eventually the parents of the boy had said, no, we're not having this, we want our rights. They'd employed a solicitor. And they went to... he was then formally excluded. They went to appeal. The appeals panel said, head teacher, you're right in your decision, but because you've taken so long, because you tried to both look after the school's interest and the boy's interest, it's taken too long, so we're putting him back in. And that just seems to me, when an appeals panel say, well, you've gone a little out of process, a little out of procedure, therefore, against the head teacher's view that this was not right, either for the boy or the other children in that school, it's just a crazy decision.
Well, you say that, but, I mean, as someone who is part of the legislative body, then you understand that if you set down some rules, then you can't allow people to disregard part of them when it doesn't suit them. So although it might have been a technicality, that presumably this appeals panel are correct.
There's a level of madness involved in that, and certainly an abandonment of common sense, isn't there? This is about the safety and the best interests of children, because there is a... I just don't think procedure should take precedence over the basic safety of children. And if panels are saying that it does, then I think they're wrong. You're not dealing with the absolute technical letter of the law here. You're dealing with a school that a boy goes to and whether or not it is safe for other boys to go to that school. I think when you get into the high courts and you're dealing with the exact letter of the law, then sometimes common sense does have to go out of the window, because unfortunately that's the case, because that's how courts work. But it shouldn't be. You shouldn't have that level of legality when you're dealing with schools, I don't think. I mean,
well, some people say that you should have that because you're dealing with whatever this lad may have done. You're dealing with his education and his future prospects.
Yeah. Some people say that. I don't agree with them. I think when a teacher has made what I think is a reasonable decision, it's certainly in line with what the Prime Minister and the government are saying, and I think it's in line with what the vast majority of people I represent think, that it is... It's a sensible course of action to have zero tolerance to taking knives into school. And if on a slight technicality, an independent appeals panel actually overturns that, then I think they're wrong and their terms of reference can and should be changed, or they should be changed. They're a fairly recent invention. And it seems to me that they're being over technical on this issue, and they've got it wrong.
Right. Well, I'll ask you this. I'll come back to that in a second, but I'll ask you this purely for the purposes of demonstration. You said that the people that you represent, presumably, you also represent the parents of this kid, or parents or parents.
I don't know who the child is.
Okay, but
and I may or may not.
But if he goes to school in your constituency, it's reasonable to assume that...
Well, the boy's coming from... He may well be a constituent.
OK. So if his parent or parents had written to you saying, Mr Stringer, our lad has been disciplined and he has been excluded, and the appeals panel... and the head is in breach of the rules and regulations, we are turning to you as our Member of Parliament to help us... to see that due process is followed. You would have had to represent the parents then, wouldn't you?
It wouldn't be the first time. I mean, just if we put this case to one side, I'll come back to it. Quite often, sometimes in the same advice bureau, I get neighbours who are at war with each other coming to complain about each other. And I think in those circumstances, I make it clear to people that whatever they say to me is confidential, and I will try to make the system... work for them. And if the boy's parents, if they were constituents, as I say, I don't know who he is, then I would put that into the system. On this occasion, a head teacher came to me, because everybody's entitled to be represented by their Member of Parliament. Only in the most extreme cases where people make racist comments or something, do I say, no, I'm not taking that up. I think I've done it about twice since I've been a Member of Parliament. So I will say you're entitled to what you're entitled to under whatever procedures and the law, but I will also make my judgment that the rules and the processes are wrong, and the head teacher, who I know and respect, has written me a letter saying that this is an impossible situation. Can I take this to the highest levels, and can I get the system changed? And that's what I'm trying to do. But in doing that, I wouldn't deny anybody the right of representation in their interest, but I would also make it clear what my views were. I mean, that's one of the problems. No, it's not a problem, it's just the world we live in that members of Parliament deal with all the time.
OK, you talked about changing the system. How much do you know about these appeals panels?
Well, they're a bit secretive. I don't know very much.
I do.
Oh, you know more than me. Well, I should ask you the question.
Let me help you. Only because I know people who are in teaching and who have spoken to me about the bizarre situation that a head teacher can make a decision And in some cases, in fact, in one case, it was because of a serious assault on a teacher, the child was excluded, and the appeals panel, at which, incidentally, the parents, the family, are allowed to have legal representation, but the school is not, the appeals panel can then overturn any judgment that the head teacher has made and make the school take this kid back, so the kid can walk back into the class of the teacher that he or she has assaulted, and everyone has to put up with it.
Now, well, that's really the point I'm making. That's unreasonable. What I don't know, I know that about appeals panels. What I don't know is who is on them, how they're appointed.
Like the pools panel.
They're a bit like the panel that used to sort of appoint magistrates. They're a bit secretive, I think.
Right.
I mean, I don't know. This is something that's come to me in the last week. I've taken the issue up and I've asked the Prime Minister to look at it, and I'm learning very quickly about this process. I understand that when David Blunkett set these panels up, that he wanted to give them strict guidance on issues like the one you've just brought up, that if there is an assault on a teacher, if there is a knife or a gun brought into school, then the panels shouldn't have the right to overturn the head teacher's decision. And I think when David left the Department of Education, that advice was never put in. I'm pursuing that matter at the moment. But I just think when you're dealing with the basic security of schools and issues like that, then in 99% of times, particularly when it's security, you have to take the head's view. He's got the interests both of the school and the other children to look at, and he has to have made a complete mess of something, really, for an appeals panel to overturn it. But they don't seem to be looking at it in that way.
It isn't, though, aren't we in an age now where a head teacher can no longer be completely autonomous like that? Pupils must have the right to, students, I think they're called, aren't they, must have the right to appeal, mustn't they?
Yes, and you need a second view, and you often need reconciliation if things have gone wrong. If, you know, there are all sorts of situations that happen in schools that are resolvable. And you don't want pupils or students excluding from schools. It's a fairly extreme action which can affect the future prospects of that young man or young woman forever. You know, it can change their course of their life quite dramatically. So there should be a sort of a right of appeal and a second opinion. And what I'm saying is, when it comes to violent attacks on teachers, when it comes to taking weapons into school, then I think there should be a pretty absolute support for the head teacher's view. I think there should be a policy of zero tolerance in those situations.
Okay. So have you undertaken this personally?
Undertaken what personally?
The review of the procedure.
The Prime Minister has said he will look at it. I am learning about it so that I can have a more informed view than just about the... I've got an informed view about the judgment they've made. I don't know enough about the detail of how these people are appointed, who these people are, and the exact powers that the panels have at the moment to come up with a solution about how those powers can be limited so they don't make decisions which I think are unreasonable and unjustifiable and are making life, not just in this school, you've given another example, there are many examples, I think, throughout the country, examples that we should have a system that where that kind of thing doesn't and can't happen.
You knew David Blunkett, didn't you?
Known him for a long, long time, yes.
Well, ring him.
I will, probably.
So, David, who are these? Yeah, ask him.
I will, but things have happened since he was there. I will talk to David. I've known him when he was leader of Sheffield and I was leader of Manchester.
Oh, but of course.
I will talk to David, but...
I'm only trying to help, Graham.
You all always help, apart from on your comments about football. But... the first port of call for most members of Parliament when you come across a new situation is to go to the House of Commons Library, which is an excellent facility, and they will give me chapter and verse on the history and of how these things were set up and what powers they have.
Well, you do, but if the book on these panels isn't there, can you reserve it for £1?
It's free. Yes, you can. They will get a book from anywhere in the country and often anywhere in Europe for you. It is a wonder. It's one of the privileges of being a member of Parliament.
So it's free for MPs, but it's £1 at Prestwich Library.
Well, that's probably because it's in Bury.
Yeah.
I don't want to be rude about Bury. I like Bury very much. Yes. But I think if you go into a Manchester library, it's free.
Is it really?
I think so. You'll probably get 100 listeners now telling me I've got that wrong, but it certainly used to be free.
All right, then, listen. Well, will you do something for us? When you find out who comprises these panels, will you let us know?
Because yeah, I'm always delighted to come and chat to you.
Well, by all means. While you're on, I'm not going to ask you about the World Cup. I'm going to ask you this. David Davis, you've heard about his theory.
I just heard you talking about death rays and taser guns, yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Well, that's stock in trade, that guy. Yeah, he thinks that anyone faced... I'm not sure what his actual definition of who would be eligible, but presumably any reasonable person should be allowed to keep a taser gun in the house in order to deter or disable... a burglar who might enter the premises. What do you think about that?
I think David Davis is often a very reasonable person for a Conservative. On this one, I think he's barking. I mean, we're just talking about guns and knives. The problem if you sort of flood the country full of tasers, they won't just stay in the hands of reasonable people who want to protect themselves and their houses. They would be on the streets of Prestwich and Ancoats and Blakely very quickly. And that is, we don't want more weapons, we want less weapons in people's hands. So, I mean, I think David Davis, if I would put it in slightly more polite terms, has just got it completely and totally wrong.
Okay, well, I think there'll be one or two people who will probably come down on David Davis's side in this one. I think Tony Martin might figure in some of the conversations we're going to have later, but that wasn't what we asked you to comment on. Principally, it was the schools thing.
Yeah.
All right, but as I say, do let us know, because I know some people in the teaching profession who are absolutely, they feel that they do, and they go to a lot of trouble, they go to a lot of process, and as you rightly say, exclusion, as it's now called, is very much a last resort. And then when a panel overturns it, it just destroys what little authority the school has.
Well, that's my point, and particularly, you know, you made the point that people have a right to appeal, and they do, and I think a panel should have to have extremely good grounds to overturn a head's decision, and actually I find it impossible to think what those grounds could be if there is violence against teachers or taking weapons into school. And the fact that this panel has said there is a process gone on here, you should have done it differently, but you're right. I just think it's against common sense, and it's against the interests of both the boy who's excluded, the other boys in that school, and the school itself.
All right, Graham, thanks for joining us. We'll let you carry on. I know there's no all-night sittings anymore, but I'm sure you have a busy day ahead.
I'll come back on and talk to you about it again, Jim.
That would be great if you could give us the detail about that, because it would be interesting to find out who they are. That was Graham Stringer, MP for Blakely. If you've just joined us, he was talking about the fact that he raised the question in the House of Commons, the matter of the pupil at a school in Blakely who was excluded for taking a knife into school. And apparently, according to Graham, on a technicality, because of the head didn't follow the procedure, apparently through trying to be too reasonable, in actual fact, he had the exclusion overturned by an appeals panel, and this kid can go back to school. Don't know his identity, don't know the school, but that's the case. And they heard Graham give us his word that he will let us know who these people are who form these panels. If you've had some experience of that, or if you think that the rights of the malefactor, whether it's at school or in some of the other things we've dredged up to talk about tonight, the rights of the malefactor are represented above those of the miscreant. That's the baddie and the goodie. the malefactor as opposed to the law-abiding citizen, then 0161 288 0103. In fact, a text has just appeared in front of me as I've been speaking. Did you see the story in the paper? Yeah, of course, the car thief who refused to move off the roof. Was he on the roof of a police station? He was chucking bricks and roof tiles at the police, so as not to breach his human rights, he was supplied with cigarettes and a Pepsi and Kentucky Fried Chicken. Well, that'd probably get him down there. He refused a can as it was already open, so they gave him a bottle. Excellent. They should have put a powerful laxative in it, shouldn't they, actually? That would be, you try looking tough and maintaining your dignity when you've blemished both legs. Anyway, I don't think I'd make a very good Home Secretary, would I, really, thinking about it? 0161 288 0103. Got some more stuff to chuck at you in a second. And I've just been told by the flaming birthday girl that we're going to speak to someone operating at the other extreme of the law. If you're concerned about leniency, wait until you hear who we're going to talk to next. 0161 288 0103. At your leisure, and join us on Key 103.
The biggest football tournament in the universe is just around the corner.
England in front, thank goodness for that!
Saw England go through to Germany 2006!
And you could score your own FIFA World Cup 2006 package with the News of the World and Key 103. Listen to Steve Peng from 9 a.m. this Sunday and bag yourself a widescreen TV, mini fridge and loads of England gear. Win with World Cup Score, the definitive guide to the World Cup, only with the News of the World and Key 103.
How was it?
Agonising! I was under, so I couldn't move or speak, but I could feel everything. The heat from the lamps, the villainous scalpel, the strange probing in...
Sometimes you have to see something to believe it, like 500 minutes and 100 texts for just £17.50 a month with 3 months half-price line rental on the Nokia 6234. Available at your local Vodafone store.
Then the aliens beamed me back, which explains this paunch. It's an alien growing inside me. Kill me now, Si, kill me!
You had an ingrowing toenail.
Subject to availability in connection to an 18-month term contract, condition supply.
Can I help you, sir?
Yes, I've just come back from holiday to find I was charged extra for using my card abroad.
Not a charge, sir, that's a tip.
A tip?
Yes, people love tipping abroad. They'll tip anything. Restaurants, doormen, taxis, beach attendants, policemen, so when in Rome...
Yeah, I didn't go to Rome.
Oh, you must. Look, it's just that people do things differently in other countries. That's why we call them foreign. And we thought you'd like to get the full experience.
Unlike some places, Nationwide don't charge you any extra when you use your cards abroad. After all, it's your money, whatever the currency.
Aren't tips meant to be optional?
They are optional, and we opted to take your money. Bye.
Nationwide. Proud to be different.
This is The Story's self-titled album. Wonderful songs and instinctively beautiful harmonies. An incredibly accomplished debut album. Includes the singles Be By Your Side and Cinnamon. With live performances not to be missed. Catch The Stories on the road with Elton John this summer. The Stories album is a perfectly polished gem. It's out now.
Our new IKEA store opens in Ashton-under-Lyne in October, and we're already assembling our team. We're looking for all kinds of people to work in sales, catering, customer service, warehouse and administration. In return, we offer a great working environment and flexible hours to suit your lifestyle. Putting a great team together isn't easy.
Anyone seen the Allen key?
So we're holding the IKEA job fair next week so we can all get to meet each other. We'll be at the new Oxford Park Sports Hall, Pottinger Street, Ashton-under-Lyne, from the 12th to the 17th of June, 10 until 8. That's the new Oxford Park Sports Hall, Pottinger Street, Ashton-under-Lyne. See you there.
P103 are bringing Pink, I'm Not Dead Tour to Manchester this November. Tickets are on sale now, so don't miss out. Call the Key 103 ticket line on 08701 223103 or book online at aloud.com. Pink at the MEN Arena on Sunday the 5th of November. Only with Manchester's official concert station, Key 103.
The James H. Reid phone-in on Key 103. Call now on 0161 288 0103.
It's very interesting, isn't it? Oh, by the way, hello, James H. Reeve here. As regards the bit on the roof of the police station, I think it was a police station, just had a text message here. It says, if that was Russia, I love messages which start off like that. If that was Russia, it wouldn't have been on that roof very long. It'd have been shot off. Well, perhaps he would, yeah. I think that might very well have happened in other places as well. I love it when people say, if that was Russia. Before the Iron Curtain came down, I was often advised to go and live in Russia. Anyway, I didn't. Listen. I may have mentioned that Blakely featured large in the news today because on the one hand you've got this case about the kid chucked out of school and then reinstated, but he's not the only felon in the district. What about this, eh? £75 fine. Fixed penalty for doing what? Well, let's ask Kerry McMahon from Blakely, who's just give us a ring. Man of the moment. Hello, Kerry.
Hi, James.
Hi, Kerry.
Well, you know, I heard you on the radio, mate. What happened was, I just went in to book an holiday at the travel agent. I actually come out of there because my son was screaming. Took him over to the tippy, you know, to get some chips.
Yeah.
And, we sat down on the bench. I was feeding my son his chip, and he was throwing some down, you know, at the birds.
Yeah.
Once we actually finished his chip, two guys come over in, you know, shirt, tie, pants and shoes and that. And they turned around and says, I'm going to issue you with a £75 fine. So I was like gobsmacked.
Was this in a park?
Yeah, it was. Do you know Middleton Gardens?
Yeah, I do. Yeah, slightly.
It was just there, mate. You know, and I was just fuming. I was swearing at them and everything which I shouldn't have. You know, because what they were saying, and we actually turned around and says it's littering. But you know what I mean? People actually sit there and actually feed the birds, and nothing's actually been done about it, you know. And they were saying, like, there's signs all over Middleton Gardens. When they actually gave me the ticket, I was that mad. I walked around the gardens, and there was no signs anywhere. My missus went over to them and told them there's no signs. And they says they are signs. And we asked them where, and they wouldn't answer. In the paper today, I was reading the article that got put in, and it says there was a fixed penalty for £25. But when
£25?
But when I went down, because I got a phone call from Channel M to meet them in Middleton, they actually walked around the gardens with me, and they couldn't actually, you know, see any signs anywhere.
Yeah.
So, and they was wondering, like, where are the signs? Because they say in the paper, it stated, like, there was a sign for a penalty if you feed the pigeons for £25. You know, and even they couldn't find it.
Right. No. There's no sign in the park about feeding the pigeons.
No, none whatsoever. But like I was saying, in the paper, I don't know if you've read it today, in the Evening News and in the Guardian, is saying it actually states it's actually a sign for a £25 fixed penalty.
Right.
You know, and I get banned with a £75, which is out of order. You know, just for my son throwing chips to the pigeons. But, like, you know, there's people, generations of people, they actually feed pigeons, as you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So why hasn't anything been done? This is what I don't understand. Why hasn't anything been done about it in the past?
Well, I've just been handed a copy of a report on this, and it says you have got no right of appeal against the notice.
Yeah, that's what it states in the paper as well. You know, but like I said to the, you know, Channel N, the is it Granada? I will fight it all the way because, you know, I'm not really bothered because, you know, at the end of the day, we shouldn't have this. Because there was other people, when I got this ticket, like I was saying, there's two gentlemen there. There was other people sat in the gardens actually throwing chips to the pigeons. And I, like, turned around and said to them, there's people over there, you know, throwing chips. Are you going to do anything about it? And they turned around and said to me, no, because I haven't seen them do anything. You know what I mean?
Oh, this is madness, this. This is bonkers, this.
And, like, I don't know if you watched the 6 o'clock news today on Granada. Yeah?
I didn't as it happened. Go on.
Yeah. It actually filmed people throwing chips to the pigeons. So where, you know what I mean, where was the wardens, whatever you call them?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's out of order.
So, I mean, I don't know this, and I don't know whether you know this, Kerry, but presumably, if you go to court, you will be going to court not for feeding pigeons, but for non-payment of a fine.
No, I didn't know that.
It seems to me, because that will be what you will go to court for, will be for not paying the fixed penalty.
Stupid.
Oh, well, it's very interesting, this. Yeah. So, what are you doing? Are you getting any legal advice, or what are you going to do?
Well, I am going to actually seek legal advice. I was going to go today, but with me waiting for, like, the Granada people coming to interview me, once they'd finished, I had to take my daughter to nursery, and I haven't really had time.
All right.
So I'm going to pop down to a solicitor's tomorrow and find out what I can do about it, you know?
All right, mate.
It's just totally out of order, you know what I mean?
Some people will say, you know, actually, if you read the Act, and we did all this over, you know, the girl who was fined £75 for leaving a lolly stick on a wall?
No, I didn't hear about it.
Yeah, this was a girl, I think, from Ashton. Left a lolly stick on a wall.
Yeah.
In the city centre, and got a £75 ticket.
Yeah.
And the Act says that they've got you bang to rights, actually, because you are causing or allowing something to fall onto the footpath. So you can't argue about that. But I worry. I mean, and now, not that I ever did, you understand, but I won't drop a dimp in the street now.
Yeah.
Because you never know, some herbert with a cap on might emerge from behind a pillar and say, right, that'll be £50.
Yeah, I know what you mean, you know what I mean? It's just bang out of order because, you know what I mean? If you go back, say, about 10 years ago, you know what I mean? You'd sit there, you could feed the pigeons and nothing would have actually happened. And now, you know what I mean? The council have actually turned it all around. You know what I mean? It's just like us. You know what I mean? You've got to be fed. You know what I mean? So there's birds out there, you know what I mean?
I do know what you mean.
It might be vermin. People call them vermin, yeah?
Yeah, well, yeah, so, they are filthy, but yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but you know what I mean? They're actually a delict, whatever you call it. You know, some people actually eat pigeons.
Oh, I believe so, yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's just, mind-bubbling at the moment to me.
All right. Well, listen, Kerry. We'll monitor you and find out how you go on. But you're joining a long list of rather puzzling examples of this new zeal about litter. Thanks for giving us a ring, pal. That's Kerry McMahon in Blakely. £75 for can you imagine how much money the lawyers are going to make out of this? I was going to say for feeding the pigeons, or was he? I put it to you. My lord. So we've now had, there's the woman who was, she was fined £1,000 for putting the wrong sort of rubbish in a dustbin. We've got the bloke who was fined £1,000 for putting his feet on a bench on a railway station with his boots on. £1,000. We've had the woman who's been £1,600 for, alright, apparently she is a serial, or rather the dog is, well no, the dog's not. But someone involved in this is a serial offender because she has done it a few times, but she's been fined £1,600. We've got £75 for leaving a lolly stick near the Corn Exchange, whatever it's called now. And if you go on the top of a police station and throw bricks down at the people below, you get a Kentucky Fried Chicken, which some might feel is cruel and unusual punishment if you look at the ingredients. But it's an interesting contrast. We're going to speak to somebody from about this expulsion thing and having decisions overturned. 0161 288 0103. You can compare and contrast it with some of the other examples of crime and punishment, which in particular the increased sentence by what a lot of people consider to be a trifling amount in the case of the bloke who raped a 3-month-old child. And also the suggestion, now that he's been burgled, suddenly the Shadow Home Secretary, he really wants something doing about burglary. He suggests that all responsible citizens should be issued with a taser stun gun in order to deter or disarm intruders on their premises. 0161 288 0103. This is James H. Reeve on Key 103, 10 minutes to 11. And we're going to talk to a head teacher about this schools thing next.
Live like a footballer's wife with £1,000 to spend at the Lowry Outlet Mall, Salford Quays. Log on to key103.co.uk today for more info.
Finger, oh, it's agony. Can you please bring me one of those, oh, what's his name? Those new, extremely good, fast-healing, hard-working, incredibly durable thingies that stay stuck, you know, those amazingly strong, really reliable, breathable, oh, what are they called? Totally flexible, ingenious, miracle of modern science, oh, you know, those plasters.
Oh, you mean the Savlon Advanced Plaster?
Oh, hurry up, I'm dying.
New Savlon Advanced Plasters, the only family plasters you'll ever need.
You have 20 seconds on the City of Manchester Star. Starting now, there's a new TV channel that is totally focused on Manchester. What is that channel? Correct, eh? There's a new show called M Music Live featuring the best live acts in Manchester on which TV channel?
I know this one.
Correct. City Life is a new entertainment show featuring nightlife in Manchester on which channel?
Let me think.
Correct. You have scored maximum points.
Channel M is the all-new TV station for Manchester with more news, more sport, more entertainment, more Manchester full stop. Channel M, now on Sky Guide 203, NTL 26 and free-to-air frequency 39.
The James H. Reeve phone-in on Key 103. Call now on 0161 288 0103.
Don't forget, of course, we will be... it's time, actually, for a reappraisal, isn't it, of our stance on the cosmic order in question. I think we've neglected that, but it seems to have worked for Noel, because he's just received... he's just secured a book deal for £500,000. So... because he cosmically ordered it, to write a book about cosmic ordering.
Yeah.
Yeah. Does nobody else... Can nobody else see what's happened there? No, it must just be me. Right. Rob is somewhere in Manchester. More than that, we're not going to say for the moment. You're a head teacher, Rob, I understand.
I am, James. Yeah, I'm serving primary school head teacher at the moment.
Okay.
We actually discussed this similar issue about 12 months ago, to be honest with you.
And things haven't improved?
Certainly not, no. You know, you Tony Blair talking about tough on crime, tough on the causes of crime and things like that. But they don't follow up when it comes to, you know, you start at school, obviously, you start at home, basically, as we've discussed previously. You know, you start at parents, they set the standard at home. And we'll try and follow it through at school. But as a head teacher, I feel like I'm fighting with both hands tied behind my back when it comes to exclusions. Because in my particular context, what I'm trying to do is turn around the school. We've been very successful in terms of our behaviour management and our systems that we've got in place, but there's got to be the bottom line in the school, particularly if you want to raise standards in education and learning. And that bottom line, you know, comes down to things like, you know, spitting at people or hitting people, things that you would expect should be covered in the general society.
Things you would think it was hardly necessary to point out.
Exactly. Things that should be stating the bleeding obvious, aren't you? To be quite honest with you.
Yeah.
But when it comes to it, when you actually then do take the decision to exclude a child, which isn't a decision that you take lightly, and I'm sure the head teacher at North Manchester, which I was a pupil at, believe it or not, I'm sure that head teacher did everything he could before he decided to go for the ultimate sanction, which is an exclusion. And when you come to it, you can then be challenged. As a head teacher, your actual standing in society, I think, is diminishing daily. Because people, I think generally in society, people don't respect each other anyway, to be honest with you. But as a head teacher, I feel firmly that, you know, I can change people's lives. That's why I went into teaching, and give something back to society. You know, as cliche that it might sound, that's what I want to do.
I mean, you do sound, funny, I was thinking about this today, I mean, you do sound a bit of a grumpy old man there, because thuggery is not new.
Indeed.
Not brand new, is it?
No,
I know, you know, because, I mean, let's face it, during the war there was no violence, was there?
Well, of course, no, of course. 2 million people got killed, that's all.
Oh, yeah, there is that, yeah.
Forget about that.
Yeah.
No, but I mean, I think I've not come from a situation where, born with a silver spoon in my mouth and all that kind of thing. And I know how tough a school can be. North Manchester has always been quite a tough area. And the schools, you know, you're not going to go in there and sort of expect the kids to be perfect. But Mel Woodcock, the head teacher, I read the article in the Evening News this evening. And as I was reading it, I was just thinking, I've been in this very situation. I excluded a child for a number of days for various things, for, you know, disruptive behaviour, so the other children weren't being educated, for fighting, for hurting, spitting, other things. And then my governors at the school, you know, but for the grace of God, it could be me in the same situation, because I came very close to resigning my position because I felt I couldn't change the school to the degree that I wanted to without support of people who were behind the scenes. And the independent review panels are faceless people. And
I was going to ask you, could you help? Could you save Graham Stringer the price of a phone call or a visit to the all that way to the House of Commons Library by saying that, who are these people on the independent panel? But don't you know?
Well, what it tends to be is it can be retired head teachers. It can be people generally, obviously, by the very nature, independent from the actual school. But they don't necessarily have to be people who are serving teachers, which I find absolutely ridiculous. You know, people who are actually doing the job today don't necessarily get to sit on these panels. This is the problem. But the main problem for me was that I didn't feel that the system supported me, and I think Mel Woodcock will find a lot of the same thing. That, you know, you get the government giving the sound bites about, you know, we're supporting head teachers, zero tolerance, blah, blah, blah. But the systems aren't in place. We're not being supported. It's a very lonely place as a head teacher. When do you know what starts to hit the fan when all this kicks off? Because parents, you know, fair enough, do want to look after their children. But you are making a moral stand on something. I think that's quite right. If someone's hitting and hurting other people, then the other children deserve to be safe in school. My daughter goes to school, I expect her to be safe. And I don't think that's unreasonable, do you?
No, of course not, no.
But society seems to deem that is unreasonable. The way the society is going, my school is a very inclusive school, and I know you love that word, but we're a very inclusive school, and we give everyone an equal chance, more than an equal chance, in fact. But to me, the way the things are shifting is that we're forgetting about the needs of the many for the needs of the few, and that can't be right at the end of the day.
I see. I mean, obviously, I would take that. I would agree with you all the way on that. Thinking back to my own school days, it's over 15 years ago now.
Well, it was Manchester Grammar, wasn't it, James?
But of course, yeah.
We'll say no more.
Right. Yeah. But there were, I mean, at primary school and at secondary school, there were teachers who, I mean, they were pretty well, their word was law, and it didn't occur to you to argue the toss.
No.
Because they were an authority figure.
But it doesn't, I mean, the thing is, that's it, it's an authority figure, but my own mantra has been that I'm firm but fair with the children. And that's what helped me to get through my career and get to the position that I'm in today, because the children know where they stand. There needs to be structure in a classroom, and people do need to respect the teacher. But the teacher does need to earn that respect. They don't just get the respect.
Yeah, but also, you can't allow teachers to dish out summary justice.
No, exactly.
There's got to be some sort of...
No one's saying that, though, James, are they? Who's saying that? No one's mentioned any of this, that summary justice is being meted out. When it comes to making an exclusion, you would not believe the amount of paperwork that you have to have in place. It is like being a solicitor. When you're putting that information together, and quite rightly, as I said before, the other side, as it is, in terms of parents, can get legal representation. And, you know, when I've been putting cases together, I'm looking at it, I'm thinking, I'm spending like a full day putting a case together, just like a solicitor would do. I'm no legal eagle. And then things is, a solicitor could come in and that would blow me out of the water, because I'm sure they would find plenty of technicalities. But at the end of the day, the morality of it is there. And children deserve to be safe, and children deserve to be educated, and the system doesn't support us.
Right, just to go back to the solicitor thing, that is, I do understand this correctly, don't I, that the school is not allowed legal representation, but the plaintiff is.
I'm not certain on that one myself. Unfortunately, I'm not about to go that far with it. But it wouldn't surprise me. That would not surprise me in the least, because the system is loaded. Yeah, the system is totally loaded. And what tends to happen when you try to get the information clarified in terms of law, then as a head teacher, you think you'll be able to go to somebody and say, right, can you tell me definitively what is the way we go about this? No one seems to know the answer. The law is very murky about it. Just in the same in the way when Blunkett said, right, people can now be restrained in school, but there was no definition of what is reasonable force to deal with a child who's kicking off big time.
Of course, that's right. Yes.
Until you get to court. And then a judge says, well, actually, I'm going to now say, well, that was over the top. There you go. Your career's finished. Yeah. Good night, Vienna, you know? And I think what really frustrates me is that we've got a government here who I thought would do great things, actually, when they came in 97. I've been, how wrong I've been on that one. But they're full of it. They're talking about justice and they're talking about social justice and everything else. But we're forgetting that there needs to be standards right the way through. And that includes the schools, it includes society. And what happens is when we try and follow that mantra, we're let down by the system. And Blair and his cronies are to blame for that. The blame lies squarely at their door at the end of the day.
All right, let's go on to the practicalities of it. I mean, this decision that's been in all the papers today, apparently it was on a technicality, and apparently they delivered the verdict with a heavy heart. But I suppose they said, yeah.
Well, that's the same for the guy today who's got extended his parole to 8 years for raping a 3-month-old child. You know, people are working in a system where their hands are tied. That's what we're being told, aren't we?
Well, I'm very puzzled by this. I once spoke to, and it really was a very unpleasant experience, Michael Howard. And honestly, he does make your flesh crawl, seriously. For some reason, you just felt as if he was looking right through you, a very strange man.
You didn't ask him the same question a dozen times, unlike Paxman.
No, it was one of these where, that was one of the funniest things ever.
It was.
But it was one of these where a PA comes along and says, right, you've had your 5 minutes. But anyway, he was going on about judges and sentencing policy and all the rest of it. And I said, yeah, but hang on. The government sets down the sentencing guidelines.
Yeah.
So, anyway, at that point, this woman says, righto, thank you, 5 minutes. Right, that was the end of that, right.
Yeah.
So I don't know. But
what I will say, James, is that the politicians, and particularly, I've got a history with Graham Schenker, by the way, because of a 19-year-old involved in the anti-poll tax stuff. I actually was accused on the front page of the Evening News of holding him hostage in Harperay Neighbourhood Centre, and we actually closed the door so the coats couldn't get nicked. But there you go, that's another story. But politicians, you know, where's Graham Schenker been for everyone else who's gone through this, you know?
Well, he does have his surgery and all, and he did say he has to deal with all sorts of complaints.
I hope he recovers soon from it.
No, you don't be deliberate. You're being deliberately frivolous now. But look, I want to ask you something seriously now. Okay, this panel said that, and I think that's what Graham Stringer implied. He said, they looked at it and said, well, actually, you know, obviously the thing to do with a kid with a knife is to chuck him out of school, but you didn't do this, that, and the other.
Didn't follow, exactly.
Okay. So,
exactly.
But you tell me, what happens then? And I don't know the precise details, but there have been a couple of cases. There was the case of the kid who wrote obscene graffiti all over the school about one of the teachers.
Poundswick, wasn't it? Yeah, years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then there was this case of the assault on a teacher where the panel overturned the expulsion decision and the exclusion, whatever. Now, you tell me, as a head teacher, what that does to the relationship between the staff and the pupils or students, whatever you call them.
Well, I think from my point of view, first of all, you know, I've got a responsibility as a head teacher to the staff as well as the pupils in a school. And for me, if I'm not allowed to do my job properly, my staff need to know that they're going to be supported as well. Similarly, the pupils need to be supported. And if the staff member steps out of order and is evidence to prove that, then you have to deal with that in the same way. But like you say, how can you work with somebody who has assaulted a colleague and been allowed in? Because if you or I were working in a factory or in an office and we came to blows, then the chances are we're going to get sacked, aren't we? We've been breached of the discipline code in work.
Well, it's normal summary dismissal, isn't it?
Exactly. Yeah. You're sacked from the spot, aren't you, if you're scrapping in. So, I mean, OK, depends on the age of the child, et cetera, et cetera. But for me, if children are laying their hands on my members of staff, depending, even down to children as young as 6 and 7, and possibly even 5, then they need to know that they need to be the bottom line, and people cannot lay their hands on members of my staff. That's not going to happen. But even so, even in the back of your mind all the time, you're thinking, right, can this be challenged? And will it be frowned upon? Because what happens is the local education authority have their targets with regard to exclusions, and the government look at that, the FES look at that, Ofsted look at that. You know, my school will look at that when they come in to inspect us.
Wait a minute. You're saying that presumably the government aims to reduce the number of exclusions.
Exactly.
Because that means the amount of misbehaviour must be coming down.
Wise in statistics, James.
Right, so this is like breathing on a thermometer.
Yep.
Which makes it look as if it's gone warmer everywhere else.
It's political. So LEAs do not want to, you know, LEAs are judged on various standards and different measures are used to do that. But, you know, if one LEA, let's for example just say, I don't know, let's say Manchester has got, say, you know, 300 exclusions in a year.
Yeah.
And then another authority down the road, say Bolton, has got 100, then there's going to be pressure on Manchester to bring it down closer to Bolton. But it doesn't mean that Bolton's a better authority than Manchester. But there's a lot of politics involved in it.
Cause and effect.
And what you've got to look at there, though, is, I mean, in relation to this, from what I've read and what I've heard, in terms of the North Manchester case, is that the head teacher looked to give this child a managed move, didn't he?
Apparently
to another school,
yeah.
Which is something which has been brought in as part of that. And I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing, because what you're trying to then do, and he's trying to do this kid a favour. You know, he's getting this, he's had it in the neck for this, but he's actually tried to do him a favour. A managed move means he doesn't get a permanent exclusion on his record.
Oh, is that right?
A managed move means that he doesn't get a perm X. So a permanent exclusion on your record doesn't look too clever, and finding another school then is going to be very hard. Although schools still have to take these kids. And what they're doing is they're closing down more of the schools, you know, for want of a better word, a special school. But they're closing down those units and bringing children into the mainstream. Fine. I'm all for that. I'm all for inclusion and bring people in and let them get on with it and work within, if I want, you know, again, inverted commas, a normal setting, yeah?
Right.
But it's got a bit of bottom line for everybody. We do differentiate the curriculum. We do differentiate. And we bend the rules depending on the needs of the child. Everyone's treated, you know what I mean?
Okay, but something I want to ask you now is, we've got to move on, but these panels, and I don't know whether you know this, but can they say, right, I'm sorry, we reverse the decision of the headmaster, but we would warn the pupil about his future conduct or something like that? Can they impose conditions, or is it just confirmation or rejection?
In terms of conditions, as far as I'm aware, they can't meet conditions. It's a basically, we either confirm the exclusion or we overturn the exclusion. And that is a hell of a power, isn't it, James?
Well, it is, yeah.
And as a head teacher, you would think that the decision would be, you think people do have, needs to be, you know, checks and balances for everything, but head teachers need to be able to make those decisions in confidence. And a lot of head teachers today, I'll tell you right now, are not able to do that, and they shy away from it. And for me, you can't shy away from those decisions if you want to effect change and you want to move the school forward. And it's a sorry time for us, really, in education at the moment.
All right, Rob. Well, listen, thanks for joining us. You don't sound any more cheerful than you were.
I'm a grumpy old man. I've been told many times.
Well, I think there is some justification for that in certain circumstances. We'll have to leave it there. So that was Rob, head teacher somewhere in Manchester. Commenting on, the many implications of this decision to reverse the exclusion of a kid chucked out of a school in Blakely for taking a knife into school, thrown out and then reinstated after the verdict of the appeals panel. Not the pools panel, although you may very well feel that decision makes about as much sense as some of the pools panel's findings. Whoops, mentioned football. Mustn't do that. The Shadow Home Secretary text message here. The Shadow Home Secretary is right, but cut out this taser nonsense. Give them a rocket-propelled grenade. Just cut out the magistrates. Thank you. Hugo Drax says, James, thick parents breed thick children. Prevent the thick parents from procreating, and the problems will solve themselves. Well, thank you, Hugo. That was actually a theory very much espoused at one time by someone generally recognised as the greatest British Prime Minister of them all, Winston Churchill. Oh, he was a big fan of that theory. Oh, yes, he was. Oh, yes. Oh, I think you'll find him right. And Marcia Mello says, James, You've started summarising in a Jimmy Savile voice. Have I? Stop it. Have I? Oh. Marcia, I'm not really sure that I don't know how to do a Jimmy Savile voice. I tell you what, why don't you come on and show me? 0161-288-0103. Tonight, Matthew. It's 9 minutes past 11. It's James H. Reeve on Key 103. What have we been talking about up to now? That exclusion thing. The Noel Edmonds business. £75 fine for throwing chips to the pigeons. Again, we've had a bit of a rake of these. And also the Home Secretary and his proposal that, in fact, in a minute, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll go through the whole story for you, and then I think Jackie has got something to say. Jackie, my assistant, stroke, who has been here for... Well, let's just say this is the first birthday she's had since she's been here. So I'll know what to look forward to this time next year, won't I? We're going to have a little breather now and regroup a bit, and then we might have a Hillman. I don't know. Something will materialise. Anyway, I'm fairly confident of that. Copperfield, you're listening to Key 103.
So, will you pick Sexy Salzburg, birthplace of Mozart and setting for the Sound of Music? Or would you rather Bratislava? She's a 24-hour city, but will you keep up? Or will you have a crack at Krakow? Beautiful by day, but what a sight by night. The choice is yours.
With Sky Europe Airlines, the choice is even easier. Just £25 each way, including taxes, can get you a date with these European cities, thanks to Central Europe's largest low-cost airline. Just visit skyeurope.com. Skyeurope.com. More Europe to discover. Terms and conditions apply.
20 seconds on the City of Manchester, starting now. There's a new TV channel that is totally focused on Manchester. What is that channel? Correct.
What?
The I Love Manchester show features the culture, history and landmarks of the city. On which channel?
Oh, it's on the tip of my tongue.
Correct. Home Search is an unmissable property programme. On which channel?
Oh, yeah, it's,
Correct. You have scored maximum points.
Channel M is the all-new TV station for Manchester with more news, more sport, more entertainment, more Manchester full stop. Channel M, now on Sky Guide 203, NTL 26 and free-to-air frequency 39.
Every week, the National Blood Service needs 63,000 donors, enough to more than fill a football stadium. So during the World Cup, there is something else which needs your support. Help save a life. Call the National Blood Service on 08457 711 711 or visit blood.co.uk. A message brought to you by Key 103.
The James H. Reeve phone-in on Key 103. Call now on 0161 288 0103.
DC Rook has sent us a text message which said, James, when I was at school, we had a contest to see who could wee the highest up the toilet wall.
Nice.
He said, I always came second.
Aw.
Said, the headmaster always won. That's a very... It's beneath contempt.
Childish. A few emails have come in so far this evening. John in Salford. This was for Debbie, actually. I think we got it after she left. Hi, Debbie. As tonight is Jackie's birthday,
no.
I believe that the talk show is being done in fancy dress. How does James look in his 6-foot pink bunny rabbit costume?
You're painting pictures with words now, aren't you?
Yeah. Happy birthday, says Julie in Tellison. Thanks, Julie, and thanks to the people who sent me cards as well. What's up with your face?
This isn't quite what I had in mind.
Mark in Wigan, hi Jimbo. Now let me get this right, he says. One of the biggest sporting occasions in the world is starting tomorrow, yet you want to talk about pigeons. Who are you? Jack Duckworth. You've lost the plot.
Hey. Hey.
Hey James, when are we going to be singing happy birthday to lovely Jackie? That should have been your first priority. Get with it, Wiggy, says Mike in Salford.
Look, come on, don't...
I'm reading the emails. I am reading the
emails. Yeah, but you're supposed to go through them and, you know... The cream of the crop.
I have. These are the cream of the crop. Katie in
Bolton. I like to see the ones you've slung out.
Why don't you wish Jackie a happy birthday? It wouldn't hurt to be nice, would it? I suppose you're still sulking about her winning the argument last night, you miserable sod.
Oh, this is another figment of your imagination, isn't it? That just bellowing and going la 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 means
you... I did
you,
do
you...
that.
Oh, I think you're fine, you did.
No, I didn't.
You did that, though.
What?
Kept saying no, it isn't.
And you kept saying, yes, it is. Hello, Key 103. Seeing as you banned the World Cup for some daft reason, can we do more local celebrities or have a tantrum again? Stop acting like a five-year-old, says Chris in Denton. That's a management thing, really, isn't it? Harry in Gorton.
That wasn't a very shrewd thing to say.
No. Good evening, James. I hope you don't mind me saying, but this, but being a gentleman that you are, it would have been nice to hear you wish Jackie a happy birthday. Go on, James, be a gent.
I did before. I said when you came in, I said happy birthday. And did I give you a piece of fudge?
Yeah.
Well, there we are. What more can you want?
Yeah.
Everybody has birthdays. Hmm. I expect I've got
no,
one.
No, I'm grateful for everything I get.
Oh, there you are.
Paul in Oldham, hi, James. This World Cup ban you've put in place, will it become of any interest if England win?
Oh, well, shall we cross that bridge when we come to it, eh?
Yeah, I think that's probably it. Hi, Jackie, happy birthday. I'm sorry that your birthday spectacular show has just plunged to the level of pigeons. But that's what you get for letting James make the arrangement. He couldn't organise a thingy in a brewery. Many happy returns. Thanks, Moira.
Go on.
And lastly, hi, James, what did you get Jackie for her birthday? Piece of fudge. Something nice, such as the history of British regiments in the American Revolution. Gosh, she's a lucky girl, isn't she?
Well, I'll tell you, do you know, as a matter of fact...
Go on.
The 24th Regiment of Foot.
Mm.
That somebody said the other... Should I save this till Monday?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Because...
Save it till Monday.
Okay.
Okay.
Only the thing is, you see...
Quickly.
Yeah, the thing is, I'm right. And they're wrong.
So explain it all on Monday.
So nothing new there then, really?
No, I don't suppose there is. And the final one from Penny and Salford.
They're wrong.
Yeah.
They thought they were really smug.
Now you are.
Not smug, just secure.
Hmm. Yeah. Hello, Jackie.
They said, you know one of these questions which is like, so, well then, yeah, if you know so much, yeah. And they're wrong.
Hmm.
And I'm right.
Yeah.
I'm right.
Again.
I'm right again. That's a very, very good word.
Well, you do point out...
Just the right word for the circumstances. Mm. I'm right again. Mm. You could have said, yet again.
I could have.
Yeah?
Mm. I just said again, though. Yeah. Mm. Hello, Jackie. A very happy birthday to you. Many happy returns. Thanks, Penny. I do hope that you're having a lovely day, though I did think the old misery would have given you the night off. Mm. Well, we live in hope, don't we?
Look, Right, look, I must tell you this. This is rubbish. By the way, I'll do a recap of the things we've been talking about up to now. But I must do this one. Noel Edmonds. He's landed a book deal to write about his belief in cosmic ordering. He has landed a £500,000 book deal to write about cosmic ordering. He said he credits the philosophy for resurrecting his career with this, that nonsense. The whole point is that the theory involves each follower asking the universe to give them the six things they most want.
Mm.
Okay. Well, the Williams sisters, that counts as one, I reckon. Right. And so on and so forth.
But we never got any of
nothing
that.
Nothing has happened on this front. Right. He sparked a cosmic belief craze when TV viewers noticed cryptic drawings on his hand. Okay. Now, the point is, I hope he doesn't put this down to cosmic ordering, because he's got £500,000 to write a book about cosmic ordering. That's where the £500,000 has come from.
Mm.
Okay. But it was quite clear at the time that he got the idea from a book that somebody else has written.
Yeah, and he was quite open about it.
A German
that,
woman, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So how come...
He's now
doing getting £500,000.
Maybe it's cosmic ordering, the success story.
The Noel Edmonds way?
Yeah.
Why doesn't he order some, like, shirts that fit him?
Yeah, he could or do, couldn't he?
Trousers that don't fasten just under his armpits.
Or soap to wash his hands.
Yeah.
Mm.
Aye. There. Thank you. And,
But fair play to him, though, in a way.
No fair play to Noel Edmonds, I say. No.
But he had...
No fair play to Noel Edmonds.
He had the awful...
He's a git.
I know, but he had
He's infuriating.
I know. But he had a hard time. He lost all his work, didn't he? Blah, blah, blah. Got divorced. And then he came back, had a rubbish show that everyone loves. And now he's thinking, great, make up some rubbish
I don't love it. It's crap.
No, you don't, but
it's
a lot of people
tedious.
Do. gets nominated for a BAFTA.
Well.
Goes to Cosby Cauldron, writes a book. He's probably thinking, brilliant.
Well, of course he's thinking brilliant. Money's coming in through the roof. Gordon Ramsay, apparently, has just been turned... He's turned down, what was it, 20 million quid?
Millions, yeah.
To effing blind on another channel.
Yeah. He's just signed a new one, hasn't he, for how many years?
No, I'm all right. No, 10 million will do me.
Oh. But are you not just a tiny bit jealous that you didn't think of it?
No.
Oh.
I didn't think of effing and blinding?
No, Cosmic Ordering.
No, I'd probably... What would I do? If I started having ideas like that, I'd seek help immediately. Do a bit of cognitive therapy.
Go on.
Okay. Right, I'll do this then.
Yeah. Key 103.
Call it 25! Emil, £25,000!
I love Key 103!
If that sounds good to you, then the great news is we're doing it again. And this time round, there's even more money to be won. These are the three songs you're listening out for on Key 103's £25,000 triple play. Song 1, Sugar Babes, Push the Button. Song 2, Madonna, Like a Prayer. Song 3, Stereophonics, Handbags and Glad Rags. We will play those songs in full and in that order on Key 103 sometime soon. And when we do, we'll be giving away another £25,000 cash. Stay listening to win cash. The £25,000 triple play is playing again on Manchester's number one hit music station. Key 103.
Download your World Cup survival guide and live like a footballer's wife. Log on to key103.co.uk with the Lowry Outlet Mall, Salford Keys.
You know, there's broadband and there's broadband. And I don't want basic broadband. I want state-of-the-art ultra-secure broadband. 18 stone take-a-bullet-for-your bodyguard broadband. I want Fort Knox high-tech infrared electric fence broadband. I want steel-reinforced broadband, deadbolt broadband. I want bomb-proof, bear-trap, black belt broadband. I want safe as houses, sleep well at night, pack of Dobermans, prowl in the grounds broadband.
With BT, you get more than just the basics. Choose one of our best-ever broadband packages with Norton antivirus software to help protect you. Call 0800 032 7939. Subject to availability and survey, BT line required, conditions apply.
The James H. Reid phone-in on Key 103. Call now on 0161 288 0103.
21 minutes past 11. Text message which is in front of me and has just disappeared just when you don't want it to. You're turning into Jimmy Savile, sort of dithery in Yorkshire. All right. Happy birthday, Jackie. Do you go Nicholas in this hot weather? But this was important. Yes, if we get fined, says Luke in Stockport, if we get fined for feeding birds, then the postman should get fined for dropping the red rubber bands. Well, quite right. In fact, this occurred to me during my holiday in Dos Bidemu. I thought, exactly, the terms of the Act... The Littering Act quite clearly state what comprises, what constitutes dropping litter. And, well, it would do. And the dropping red rubber bands, exactly, it is clearly a breach of that. So I think we could take a class action against the post office? I think we could hold them to ransom over this. And I'm going to take a photograph of the red rubber band ball, so you can judge its dimensions. We're going to stick it on the website. And I meant to do this earlier in the week, we've got several contributions with messages enclosed, several envelopes of red rubber bands to add to the pile. So I'll do those for you in a bit, when I can remember what's going on. What else is happening? Yeah, David Davis, the Shadow Home Secretary, wants homeowners to be allowed to arm themselves with taser guns. Just listen to this. I'll do you the business here. This all happened because his house in, presumably in Monmouth, was broken into, and passports and £300 worth of cash was pinched. He said that he felt violated by the crime, and he wanted householders to be allowed to use electronic stun guns. Okay. The blokes who broke in used his own car to get away in, and he was asleep upstairs with his wife and his children, two kids, and his sister-in-law and her boyfriend were sleeping in the house as well, downstairs. So the burglar alarm wasn't on. Anyway, they got in, they made off with this gear. He thinks they armed themselves with a kitchen knife while we're there, but he said... He's supposed to have done a bit of boxing, hasn't he, David Davis, I think, which isn't that how he got his conk? Anyway, he said he says, shouldn't I at the very least be able to stand at the top of my stairs with a taser, which isn't going to kill somebody, and use that as a means of self-defence? So he reckons, he says the constraints on people trying to defend their homes are crazy, and he says... people should be allowed to have them. It doesn't... If you tackle a burglar, if you disable him with a taser, you're not going to do him any harm, although the evidence from the United States indicates that about 70 people, I think it is, have died through being tasered. But can you... how is that going to... You explain to me how that is going to work. I know my death ray, I think, is a much better idea because there wouldn't be any unpleasant twitching or awkward questions to answer. Because the person would simply dissipate, would vaporise. I know we're still ironing out one or two snags, but if it just... there'd be nobody around, you see, to cause any problems. It wouldn't even be like the invaders, where they leave like a bit of a smudge on the floor after they've burnt up. They would just vanish into thin air. Fantastic. That's the way to do it. Noel Edmonds is king, James. You jest when you say he is a git. So much that you need therapy, says a helpful text message. Pat in Atherton. Pat, why don't you join us on Key 103? Why ever don't you? Hello, Pat.
Hello.
Pat.
All right, James. No, I'm just... I read about what you said about schools and that.
Yes.
I worked in the school for 5 years.
Yes.
And I went through hell.
You went through hell?
Oh, well, yeah, you know, like 11 to 16, 17.
Yeah? What's hell? Come on, what do you mean it was hell?
The children.
Yes.
Well, they're not children, they're like grown-ups, aren't they, really?
Yeah, and why was it hell?
They pour buckets of water on you when you were mopping steps. You know these cones out straight? You know these cones?
The cones?
They come down the toilet and they did the thing down there and left it for you.
What?
And I had, honest James, I had 4 years out with them kids. This is their generation coming up.
What, you mean they intimidated you and...
oh, yeah.
And they taunted you?
Yeah.
So what happened? Why didn't you complain to somebody about it?
Because the headmaster would not listen. Because the kids controlled the school.
Were you in a union?
No.
Well, you should have been.
No, I went to the union. I just went for a job. Which my sister was, like a cleaner.
Yeah.
She got me this job, but it was horrendous. Two teachers got suspended.
Two teachers got suspended?
Yeah.
What for?
Because these two lads said, he hit me. And I'll give it, he put his hand on his shoulder and said, don't do that again. He hit me, he got suspended. Two teachers. One lad in behind the drama school curtains, the tax teacher. Honestly, is it horrendous?
Yeah.
You slot themselves in classrooms and jump out on you.
Right, okay, no.
There's this school I'm going about now. We finished up cleaning. Yeah. Our own keys. We had to go in the classroom and lock the door behind us.
Right.
So we could clean it so no one could go in.
Right, well, thanks for sharing that with us. I was hoping to look at things from a more conceptual point of view, really, but there we are. That was Patty Nelson. Right. Joe King says, via text, the postman cannot be fined for dropping red rubber bands. Your garden path is not public property. Well, no, it's not, and don't you forget it, Joe. never think of setting foot on it. But the public footpath is public property, and I would say that probably 70% of the rubber bands I have come across have been on public property. In any event, I could take out a civil action against the postman. But if you find them on the pavement, that's public property. So there we are. There's another example of someone smugly sending in a text message thinking, I'll just put James straight on this one, and making a bit of a knob of yourself, unfortunately. What a pity. Right. John in Salford, let's have words with you. John, you're on Key 103.
Hi, James.
Yeah.
You sound a bit off tonight, are you?
What do you mean?
The way you've been going on in the last few minutes.
What am I supposed to do? It's not radio smarm, you know.
So when we change this game to you?
Listen, well, she's getting on my nerves.
Anyway. Why? What's that? Don't want to talk about this guy who's just been given 2 years extra on his sentence.
No. Well, no, he's not been given 2 years extra on his sentence. He's got a life sentence.
Parole thing,
right. Isn't it? I was meaning... Just bear with us, John, while I go through this, because it's quite important to understand the details of this. There's this couple, you see, Alan Webster and his accomplice, whose name is Tania French.
Yeah.
He raped... I don't like to think about it for too long.
Basically, what we, yeah.
But I don't even. Yeah, I don't even know how you would do it, because a 12-week-old baby is on. How old? They're about a foot long, aren't they?
If that, James, if that.
Anyway, he raped a 12-week-old baby. And was given. He was sentenced to life imprisonment in January, which everyone would say, yeah. Quite right. Some people would say more, but we won't get into that now.
Yeah.
He was given a life sentence. And his accomplice, she was also given a life sentence, I think, because for some reason, that's why I said earlier, they're starting to sound like the new Brady and Hindley. This is appalling. Anyway, this is what happened. When you're given a life sentence... There is a condition, which is that you will be eligible for parole after a certain length of time. Okay. Are you all right? What are you doing?
I'm just getting relaxed.
It sounds as if you're opening a packet of Planters.
What are they? Come on, James, carry on.
Right. The sentence said that he would be eligible for parole, to apply for parole after 6 years. Okay, now that doesn't mean that he'd get it.
We can apply for it.
Right, so what they're saying is you cannot apply for parole until you have served 6 years. Now, his accomplice was jailed for 5 years, this Tania French. Right. Now, it's quite interesting, actually. He said that Webster might now never be released, but the five senior judges at the Court of Appeal... ruled that the six-year minimum term was too short. So we had a solicitor on a few months ago explaining this, is that you get a sentence, you are given a life sentence, but the prison sentence can form any part of that. You with me?
Yeah.
So you're sentenced to life imprisonment, but that doesn't mean you're sentenced to be in prison for life. So... some people would say that the idea that this bloke should be allowed to apply for parole anyway is ridiculous. But 6 years is taking the mickey. Anyway, they've thought about it deeply. And they must... I don't know. It'd be nice to talk to one of these to see it, so they can tell us what their reasoning is. They've said that it's not enough. 6 year is not enough. Let's make it 8. So after 8 years, you'd be able to apply for parole after raping a 12-week-old child.
It should be like in America, James, life without parole. That's it. That's the only way these people, sick, individual, are the beast. That's all they are. And the woman, how can she do it? Oh, I don't believe it. They're both sick. And that basically helps it. While they're in prison, someone doesn't actually murder them. The pair of them, because the better off without them in the society, because they're an absolute disgrace. They're not humans. There's something strange. What have been born? And what's their mother and father been like? Were they, you know what I mean? It's just, you've got to go back and look at their mother and father. Why did they give birth to these two individuals?
Well, I suppose everyone does that in good faith, although I often feel if you look round the place, you'd see people who shouldn't be allowed to breed, as I think we had a communication earlier which said, you know, normally one look at people and you think, oh, God, if they procreate, what, you know, what hope is there? In fact, I might introduce a small technical adjustment to this death ray. In fact, I must nip into engineers and see how they're getting on with it, where you could set it on low and it would just sterilise you.
I think this guy should be castrated. And the woman, well, what, I don't think you can do much with a woman, but, you know what I mean, what, she's as guilty as what he is, basically. You know, she didn't do it, but she's guilty as what he is.
Yeah, I think she got sentenced to 5 years imprisonment, and they've left that as...
I don't think that's right whatsoever.
Well, here, listen, a panel of five senior judges at the Court of Appeal, headed by the Lord Chief Justice, Lord Phillips, said that the six-year minimum sentence, in effect, that's what it is. You will do 6 years in prison, and then we'll reassess the situation. Now, they've changed that to you will do 8 years in prison, and then we'll reassess the situation. We might not necessarily give you parole, but I think what'll annoy people is the idea that he should be...
Even considered
for it after such what looks like a ridiculously short period of time.
Have you seen the parent, James? They look sicko just looking at them.
They do look as if they might have been extras in Deliverance, don't they, as to be said. Right.
Oh, something out of that Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Yeah, yeah. Listen, let me finish this, though. The panel ruled that having regard to Tanya French's youth, because she's only 19...
She was about 50.
Well, I'm afraid, yes. But she's 19, we are assured. They said she'd been corrupted by Webster, by Alan Webster, and they said that her sentence fell within the range that was properly open to the sentencing judge, and that should not be disturbed. In other words, that's none of their business, right? However, they extended his minimum period before consideration for parole to 8 years. But this is the interesting bit. The pair of them are from Hatfield, and they raped and indecently assaulted the baby, took photographs of the abuse. The baby's mother was unaware of the abuse until detectives visited her after finding the photographs at Webster's house. Okay, and the family has naturally said that they were disappointed. And, of course, this bloke had got previous convictions.
So, well, exactly, so it shouldn't be considered for parole. It's as simple as that. These judges, I tell you what, think that they're so clever. I think that's what's sicker than other people, because they give these, say, crazy sentences to people all the time. And they think that people are just going to put up with it. Well, like I say... Oh, anyone listening, they're in prison, they know who these people are. Go and kill them. Do us all a favour. Because we don't want them. And that deserves to be killed.
Well...
Sorry, James, but that is a case for people to get executed.
I know. There's also a point which has arisen in this, is that it was, presumably to save time and money, it was an idea was introduced again. I think this is David Blunkett, who we've already spoken about. I think he introduced this idea that you get a discount if you plead guilty.
That's a joke.
Okay. Now, well, that means that you know, instead of just going to trial for the sake of it and using up everybody's time and public money, presumably if you're skint, you know, it's not costing you money to employ a solicitor, the taxpayer's paying for it and all the rest of it. But so somebody today... at lunchtime was saying, yeah, but the point is this, that is to encourage people who think they might get away with it from not doing and saying, okay, I'll plead guilty. Because that saves everyone going to all the trouble and spending all that public money and what have you. It's to discourage people from thinking, well, I'll go to trial, I might as well, and who knows, I might get off. Now then, What he said was different in this case. There was no possibility of them getting off. They could not. They could not. It would have, it would not have made any sense at all for them to plead not guilty. They'd got photographs of them committing the crime. But however, and again, this doesn't really fill you with confidence when you think, well, who thought this through? Who thought this idea through? And did this possibility not occur to them? Because they pleaded guilty, they qualified for the rebate, which I think is a third off.
Yeah, the thing is that you've got to think of this baby. How old is it now? I don't know how old it must be now. It must be nearly two, probably.
I don't know. It was in January they were sentenced, wasn't it?
So how long? I'll say the baby might be about 6-7 months now, about 8 months.
Yeah.
That baby's going to have that for the rest of its life.
But
if it was a parent, would you tell that kid what happened to her? Would you not tell it? Would you not say anything?
Well, that's an interesting thing. I mean, that might actually, we might ask people what they would consider doing in those circumstances. If they want
it's
to,
an odd one, that, James. Right. It's an odd thing.
If they want to express a view, then 0161-288-0103 is the way of doing it. Would you say nothing? Would you not mention it? Although, if this is your daughter, obviously, when she reaches puberty and all the rest of it, she's going to start asking things, and things will require explaining then. Or she might, who knows, you might be having a look on the internet and come across this article about,
exactly.
So that's a very, very difficult one.
Yeah, for a start, they should be both, well, she should be sterilised, for a start, so she can't have kids ever again. Or even adopt kids, and each time he...
No, wait a minute, whoa, no, this wasn't her child.
It was a friend's.
Yeah, this is somebody else's child they're looking at.
Yeah, the thing is, James, she should not be allowed to have kids in the future. She should never be allowed to have children.
Carl, can you do that? Can you do that? Would that not be cruel and unusual punishment?
I don't think it's cruel at all, James. I think what they did was sick, cruel, depraved, and... they should be punished for the rest of their life, and basically, hopefully he won't get out of prison. Let's hope that he never gets out. Well, I'll still castrate him.
Well, I mean, castration doesn't, it's a theory which is very often brought out at times like this, and I don't think, actually, that there's any evidence that it changes people's behaviour.
All right, James, well, why keep this guy alive? The parents of this kid are paying taxes to keep him in prison.
Well, we all are.
He should be killed.
We're heading into tiresomely familiar territory.
Yeah, no, James, right? Cases like this are extreme.
Yeah, but look. Oh, dear me. This is
like... James, this is the way I feel about it. If he was in America, he'd be dead.
Yeah, yes, I know he would, and so are many hundreds of people, I think the majority of them black, who were innocent. This is the problem. Can I just explain this for anyone, just in case there's anybody left in Britain who hasn't heard me say this yet?
Go on, James.
Okay. Perfectly simple. Whether we are morally justified in taking someone's life doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. The argument, there is no need to address it. Because we've got a much bigger obstacle to overcome first. And that is to be absolutely certain. To be universally and eternally certain. Beyond any possibility of error. Any possibility whatsoever that somebody is guilty. And you might quote these two, and you might quote all the famous murderers of history. Brady and Hindley is usually a good place to start. The two Nielsens, Sutcliffe, all the lot. And you'd be absolutely right in saying that these people committed terrible crimes and are beyond doubt, beyond any doubt, guilty. However, the problem is not the past, but the future. And in the future,
If you have capital punishment available as a punishment, you have to decide if and when to use it. And when you do, you must be correct. Otherwise, you will kill an innocent person.
Yeah, and I know what you're saying, James, but it's like you said, if you did ever bring it back, they won't anyway, they're not going to do it.
No, they're not, and for that very good reason. That very good reason.
It just feels like you're keeping these people alive in prison. And there's...
I know it's frustrating, and when you think about these people and what must go on in their minds, it's an unpleasant. Apparently this bloke had hundreds of thousands of pictures of kiddie porn on his computer, apparently.
Yeah.
Right. Now I like a bit of the old favourite as much as anybody.
Yeah, well, stuff like that changes, it's sick.
I really don't understand. I would say the lower limit is probably a bit of St Trinian's. I don't think anybody objects to that, do they, really, these days? I just don't understand how that works.
Get done before, James, you know, so they had all these pictures. Was this after he'd been to court this time, is that how, before this crime was committed against his kid?
Did he what?
Was this found out before the incident with a kid?
What?
About all these pictures that he had on the computer.
No, I think it was... I'm not sure of the exact chronology, but I think it was at the... I'm not sure why he was arrested in the first place. But clearly the police found the photographs of the crime. Now, whether they subsequently went on to find the kiddie porn on his computer, I don't know. I don't know.
They can search the computer, can't they? Deleted stuff and stuff like that. Yeah. Well, this guy, I mean, he wasn't a one-off. It was just something that was in his mind anyway to do this, and it was his mindset that he was going to abuse a child. It might not have been this one. It would have been another one. It's just that this kid was a three-month-year-old baby.
Right, but, I mean, what do you do then? This is a problem, and I know that that paedophilia surfaces from time to time. Now, there has been a debate about this just lately, is that you cannot keep someone, you cannot imprison someone for a crime which they might commit.
Yeah, I know.
Okay. In which case, you might as well lock everybody up just to be on the safe side. That would leave the only people knocking about would be police officers and prison officers. Because, or would they have to lock themselves in with everybody? Anyway, it doesn't matter, right? Anyway, would there be no trouble if the only people knocking about were police officers? Would there?
No, you never know, James. No. Some of them are corrupt.
Well, you don't need to answer that immediately. Right. Anyway, but the point is. With people who do this, with child molesters and what have you, there is one, I think he's from round here somewhere, he said, he was released, and he said, I'm going to do this again. He said, he told everybody, he told the papers. He said, and it might have been like a cry for help, he said, they're letting me out, and I'm going to re-offend. I'm going to find another child. And
what, he started to release him?
Yeah, well, yeah, he served his sentence. Now, surely there must be. They assess people. Now, whether this means clearly they get it wrong because they always get massive publicity. But people who've got severe mental illness or people who've murdered are released, and apparently a tiny proportion kill somebody again.
Which we found out recently, yeah.
Yeah, I mean the reoffending rate. For murder is something like 0.001%. The reoffending rate for burglary is 70-odd%.
Yeah. Oh, I'm on, James. Oh, go on. I thought you finished.
Right. But if you are that 0.001%, that is very, very bad news indeed, isn't it? So what do you do then to when you've got people who have this condition that requires them to indulge in sexual assault of infants and child pornography. What do you do? Do you say, okay, you've served your sentence, off you go, and the next time you do it, we'll lock you up again? Or do we say, you clearly have an incurable condition, and we will lock you up, we will keep you locked up on the premise that it's a fair bet that you will reoffend if we let you out? And if we let you out in that knowledge, we are failing to protect the public. What do you do?
It's an ad, isn't it? It is.
Of course it is.
Well, did you hear about the thing? I think it's, I'm not sure, I think it was Holland or Belgium, where the paedophile, what, become MPs? I don't even know if you heard about this.
Oh, Belgium, it was rotten. It was from top to bottom, and the government was covering it all up and everything. And unfortunately, what a ghastly man, terrible bloke, who, didn't he keep a girl locked in the cellar for years or something?
I think so.
His name, unfortunately, was Andreas Pandy, who presumably in the pub was known as Andy. Anyway, I'll leave that one hanging in the air. Listen, you raise an entirely legitimate concern there, but what do you do about it? What are you doing there?
Nothing.
Okay, right. 0161 288 0103. We are actually. Oh, this is another thing as well. If you live in Salford, is it Lower Broughton? Yeah. If you live in the Lower Broughton area, I do hope, and please forgive me for mentioning the World Cup, but I do hope that you won't get excited. Actually, I think probably there won't be any need for this, because most of the people will be walking around with long faces saying, bloody bunch of clowns, I knew they wouldn't get anywhere. But just in the barely imaginable event of England actually getting somewhere in the World Cup, if you live on property owned by, is it Salford Council? Mm. Oh, yeah. Then, yeah, Prospect Housing, you've been told, don't enjoy yourself. Don't celebrate too much if England achieve anything in the World Cup. They've already been told that you can't have, the company has said that the drivers can't fly England flags from the vans and cars because it's a breach of health and safety. But, of course. And, interestingly, these two England flags, which always make you look round because you think someone's driving along with a flat tyre. Oh, you hear it coming and you think, yeah. Flying those bloody England flags out of the car window, you use about an extra litre of petrol a week.
I imagine.
Because it disrupts all the aerodynamics. Mm. A German bloke with a computer planned the car to be that shape, and you've spoiled it all. and I tell you another catastrophic thing that... was it on Channel 5 News tonight? You know these patio heaters?
Oh, yeah.
Which I've said on many occasions, they should not be allowed. They shouldn't be allowed. They should be illegal.
Why?
Because they're just a waste. They're just a complete and utter waste.
Oh, they're brilliant when you sat outside the pub.
Oh, I'm sorry, I see. Now you put it that way. Oh, I take back everything I said.
What do you mean in an environmental way?
They're environmentally preposterous.
Mm.
It's like rigging up a gas fire at your house outside.
Because you can buy them now for your own garden, because they used to be just in pubs.
Yeah. Oh, yes, I know you can. I know you can. Because, do you know how many have been sold in Britain?
Oh, about loads.
Have a guess.
Oh, 100,000.
At the latest count, 650,000.
God. How much are they?
Devices. I've no idea. I've not made any inquiries.
200 quid or something.
Look one up on the internet.
Yeah, I will.
I mean, I'd have one in the house.
Yeah.
But it's, I forget how many tons of carbon dioxide they produce as well, greenhouse gases, ridiculous. But it's...
But they are great when you sit outside the pub.
But, well, that's ridiculous. Don't be stupid.
But they are.
Oh, I see. Oh, well, Jackie's won another argument, just like she did last night, by saying, well, so ner.
No, I'm just making a point. That they're nice when you sit outside. And when it's a warm day and you've sat all afternoon outside the pub, and then the sun goes down and it's still quite nice. At this time, it gets a bit nippy. So put them on and it's nice then.
Well, yes, that defeats any other argument I can think of. Yeah, it's nice.
It's not an argument, it's just my point of view.
Yeah, but you're obviously using it as reasoning.
Well, not really.
Oh, not really then. All right, okay.
Move on.
Okay, we'll move on. It's 6 minutes to midnight. It's Key 103. James H. Reeve is here. Well, I'll do your reminder in a second, what we've been talking about. And if you've just joined in, because it has been a long day. Oh, and then we must open our bumper bundle of rubber band contributions.
And I've got emails as well. I've got loads to do.
Okay, then. We've got a lot to do. But we'll talk to Matthew in a moment. Bear with us, please.
You're just three steps from the perfect weekend. The Foster's 5 o'clock whistle. Step one, log on to key103.co.uk. Step two, email Digi. Step three, tell him your five biggest weekend anthems. These simple steps could win you a crate of Foster's to kick off the weekend in style. Entrance must be 18 and over.
Thank Foster's, it's Friday. I need a miracle.
On Key 103.
Adams.
Here.
Ahmed.
Here.
Agent Jenkins here. Year 11 maths infiltrated. Presently disguised as a yucca plant. Mission, tell pupils that with EMA, they could earn up to £30 a week if they continue in learning after 16.
Here.
Jenkins.
Here. Damn. Cover's blown. Run away. Aboard. Aboard.
To apply now, call 0808 1016 219. EMA, be in the know. Households with annual income up to £30,000 eligible.
After school, he'd give me my secret homework. He'd do gross things to me. I didn't want to tell anybody, because he'd just think I was dirty. It went on and on until I told someone. It made me realise it wasn't my fault, and I had nothing to be ashamed of. If it's happened to you, when you're ready, visit the NSPCC website, don'thideit.com. I call Childline on 0800 11 11. Remember, if you've been sexually abused, you don't have to hide it anymore.
The James H. Reeve phone-in on Key 103. Call now on 0161 288 0103.
Jackie's just been telling me what I'm sure she considers to be an amusing story.
It was funny. Anyway, I'm not going to tell it now.
Okay, well, I've got a better story than that.
Okay.
Right. I know the world's only, as far as I'm aware, the world's only thalidomide goalkeeper.
Oh, sorry.
What do you mean?
Go on.
I don't know. His name's Gary. I know. He played football. He's a thalidomide child. He's 40-odd now, I suppose.
Mm.
Played for, not professionally.
Successful.
But, played for a pub team in goal.
Any good?
As far as he's aware, he's the world's only thalidomide goalkeeper. I asked him, was he any good? And he said, well, I did edit a lot. That's a fact. He's a friend of mine.
Stop it.
What do you mean, stop it?
This must be politically incorrect.
It's a fact.
No, okay. We'll leave it there.
Matt is in Bagley.
Oh, you referred to me as Matthew before. I get suspicious when people do that.
I know.
I think I'm about to be told off.
That was just to unnerve you.
That's what your mum says when you're in trouble.
That's right, yeah, Matthew. Matthew. Remember the chap that used to play for Windsor Hospital team? He was a midget. Years back in the 70s.
No, I don't remember that.
Yeah. I think you played a charity match against them on one occasion in about 1978 or something like that.
I'm sure I would have remembered playing football
quite a little darter, he was, yes.
A person of restricted growth?
Yeah.
Not James, then.
I remember that, son.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah. You mentioned the Williams sisters earlier on being virtually interchangeable. I think they can barely be referred to as sisters, really.
I don't know, have things been going on?
Not unless they shave their nutsacks really closely, anyway.
Oh, how dare you!
Have you seen the picture of them on the website, Matt?
Oh, dear. Dear. Do you remember that old joke about Fatima Whitbread?
Oh, no, not the cricket ball joke.
No, the illegal importation of drugs.
Oh, yes.
I think you could update that one with one of the Williams sisters. Anyway.
Well, Bernard does one about a cricket ball that we can't do.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Fatima Whitbread.
Well, one of the Williams sisters got arrested because she was illegally trying to import drugs into the United States. She found £2 of crack in her knickers.
Yes, well, now, as soon as you two have finished entertaining each other...
Hello?
Hello there.
Hello, oh, I'm sorry about that.
Go on, get on with it.
I just went under a bridge.
Just a minute, this is a shambles. Why have you given me these?
Because you asked for them.
Oh, okay.
Oh, by the way, did you, the reason I'm on, the chap in Blakely, is it?
Yeah.
What do you mean, yes?
That's who we've been talking about.
The pigeons, pigeon affair.
Ah, right, yes. Mr. McMahon, Kerry McMahon.
Kerry McMahon. Well, Kerry, apparently all spot finds in this country are actually illegal.
Now, are you going
to refer back to the 1689 Bill of Rights?
The Bill of Rights.
Yeah.
Now, a fella has tried this over...
congestion charging and won.
Did he win?
He did,
Oh, well, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Somebody else tried it over some other fixed penalty fine. Legally, I was very interested in this, because a mate sent me this, an email with all this in.
All forfeitures and fines before trial.
Yeah.
Now,
a few months ago, somebody else came up with the same thing in relation to something else.
Some kind of speeding fine.
I think it was. Now then. It was parking, wasn't it? It was on
parking
fines. Yeah, it was on the spot parking fines. Now... I was thinking about this from a legal point of view, and I suspect that we might get Malcolm on talking about habeas corpus.
Possibly.
If we're really unlucky.
And Magna Carta.
Yeah.
Did you die in vain?
Right. But I think that this would probably be the legal interpretation of that, is that you are, if you are issued with a fixed penalty notice, I might be wrong, and this whole thing that you've got no appeal is that Kerry McMahon was talking about before, that might throw a bit of a spanner in the works here. But I suspect the following. If you are given a fixed penalty notice, if you refuse to accept it and elect to go for trial for the offence, then that's fine. You're going for a trial.
Yeah.
If you pay the fine... you are acquiescing. In other words, that is tantamount to a guilty plea.
Yeah.
Right. The interesting thing is, though, if you refuse to pay the fine and go to court, are you being taken to court for the offence, or are you going to court for the different offence of refusing to pay the fine?
Mm.
Because for non-payment of fines, you can be sent to prison.
But that's right, yeah, and that's it, all before trial, yeah. But of course, you can also, if there is any kind of line of defence or like local ombudsman that you can take it to, which you can do with the congestion charge, the transport authority. That's the trouble, you see.
But listen to this now. Just put all this together, and of course, it would be a lovely world if people just behaved nicely and responsibly. But they don't. So we've had to introduce laws which carry with them penalties. Now, the hope is that you will be deterred. If they put a sign up saying, penalty for dropping litter, £25, don't drop litter.
But isn't the point... they're not actually...
Oh, wait a minute. Whoa, 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 whoa. I thought I'd just started a sentence then. That is the hope. But you see, if people then break the law, then you've got to enforce it. So all these things, which are little things, like don't let your dog crap in a public place. Okay?
Mm.
Oh, right. And people do nowadays. People generally... apart from him, that bloke who plays for Bolton, whose dog crapped right outside my mate's front gate, then a lot of people are now doing the... I wouldn't like to do it myself, but they're using the inside-out plastic bag technique for picking up the Richards in question. Okay? Don't put your dirty boots...
I think you should update that, by the way, and call them Thoras from now on.
Thoras, okay, then, if you like, don't put your, do not put your boots on this British Rail bench, or rail track, or wherever it is, right? But a bloke does, so you've got to do something, you've got to enforce it. So he's fined £1,000. £1,000 for putting his feet on a bench. £1,200 for letting your dog crap somewhere. The woman who's been taken to court by, was it Nottinghamshire? Nottingham, somewhere.
Oh, for a bend, yeah.
Yeah, she'd been warned 3 or 4 times and still put some. A bloke told me, I've not been able to find it, but a bloke said a woman was done because she put a compost, your garden waste bin, she put some manure in it.
Yeah.
Now, manure is already rotted, so it won't rot in the council compost heap. It will disrupt the rotting process.
Mm.
So she's fined.
Mm.
She's fined for putting horse manure in the compost bin. Right? Mm. So we've got this mass of... they're only necessary because people...
Drowning under legislation is ridiculous.
Yeah, but the point is this, it's no good. I mean, it's perfectly reasonable to say, look, don't put stuff that won't compost, don't put it in a compost bin. That's not unreasonable, is it?
No, it's not a dog like you, none of us want to, get toxic carbon from a fauna.
Of course. So that's fine. It's not unreasonable to ask that. But because there are so many louts in the world, and so many people who can't be asked to make an effort, so you've got to say, please do that. And if somebody doesn't, you've got to say, well, no, you must do that, because it spoils it for everybody else. And if someone persists, you've got to say, right, I'm sorry, but we're going to have to introduce a penalty for this.
Yeah.
And that's why you get people being taken to court. Do you know the... All the, you've read about people...
Hang on a minute. Is there a soapbox anywhere?
I was just going to go off on a tandem then. Okay, we've had the lolly stick and the cheesy what's-it and the chip on the being fed to the pigeons and all the rest of it, right? And of course there was someone who I believe is known in the area, done for dropping a dimp outside the central library. Okay, threw a cigarette end on the ground. Claimed it was entrapment. Well, he wants to read what entrapment is before he starts all that. It wasn't, but anyway. So now I'm walking along, I've got a cigarette in my hand now. When it's finished, what I must do is, because the council haven't provided ashtrays, what I must do is walk along, swinging my arm freely so that the cig burns out, and then I've just got the dimp left, and I put it in my pocket.
Mm.
Okay, right. But then I was thinking, well, wait a minute, under the strict interpretation of the law, what happens when I flick the ash off it?
That'll be the next thing.
Well, it...
That'll be it, dropping ash, yeah.
It may be covered by existing legislation. Because it's biologically inert, it's biodegradable, but so is a cheesy what's it.
Mm.
That doesn't matter.
Mm. Yeah.
Anyway, thanks, I feel much better. Same time next week.
Just one more thing.
All right, yeah, go on.
Of course, there's the other sneaky way of paying fines as well.
What?
You make the checkout for 1p more than it's actually for, and it just plays ping pong.
Now, somebody told...
I've heard this before.
Go on, what, yeah. is this an urban myth?
No, it's not an urban myth at all, and you can...
Oh, it's gone.
Why don't you get one of those wind-up phones, you?
Well, I think I will do, actually. I think it's probably easier just to get a string and an old baked bean tin.
Your personal practices are no concern of mine.
All right, anyway. But it's not an urban myth, no. I mean, it certainly works with on-the-spot parking fines, anyway. Say you get an on-the-spot parking fine for, whatever, 40 quid.
Yeah.
You make your checkout for £40 and one penny. Apparently, the points won't go on your licence or whatever, you know, until the transaction's complete.
You're right.
And basically, they will send you back a cheque for a penny. You don't cash the cheque for a penny. And it just goes on and on and on for years and years.
This is one of these things where
it's
some...
Not urban,
no, some Burke will think, oh, well, I'll try that. And it'll end up, you'll be in prison and your car will be the size of a tea chest.
Well, possibly.
Yeah, yeah. Have you ever seen the film Top Secret, by the way?
Who's in it?
Val Kilmer and Omar Sharif.
I think I possibly have, yes.
It's arguably the funniest film ever made. The bit where Omar Sharif is put in a car crusher. In a car. He survives.
Oh.
It's the funniest thing I've ever seen. It's worth nipping down to, bobbing into Blockbusters next time you're down that way. Or any other legal.
I should certainly do that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Mm. Okay. And give her a little peck on the cheek for her birthday. There's still a few. Oh, no. It's gone now.
Mm.
Oh, well, then.
Too late.
Oh, yeah, missed it. Oh, well, we've got 12 months to look forward to the next one. Thanks very much indeed.
Yes, okay.
Martin Bagley, thank you very much indeed. I've got a text message here, says, what happens if your dog has got the squitters? Well, in that case...
The what?
The squitters.
What's the squitters? Well, I can guess what it is.
You had a touch of on holiday.
Thank you.
Well, I think you can... In fact, that's from Harry Curry.
Does there any need to...
It's a serious matter. This might be brought
what,
up.
What, my holiday?
Oh yeah, no, I'm
bowel
back.
Movements.
I'm back on the
right.
Right. There is legal precedent for this. You can be excused in the event of you being incontinent, because if you remember, there was somebody well known who got off a motoring offence by. That's right, Sir Alex Ferguson.
Wasn't it Beckham?
Oh,
no, it was Fergie, yeah.
Because otherwise he would have touched cloth, it was claimed. Unless he had used the... If he hadn't used the hard shoulder, it would have been the soft... right.
Side, yeah.
Yeah. And Tom in Ashton says, patio heaters are akin to man's last deed of monstrosity in turning Eden into Sodom and Gomorrah. They are an abomination on the earth. And we will pay, says Tom in Ashton. And Jackie can reply in almost equaling the poetry of that statement. Tom, yeah, but they're nice. So what can you do in the face of an argument like that? 0161 288 0103. It's 11 minutes past 12 and it's Friday. It's Friday. Woo. And anything happening tonight?
Well, can't think of anything in particular.
Oh, don't jip me. Wow.
Oh.
Whoa.
Whoa.
Key 103 and Nokia, rock up and play.
Bringing people together to share and enjoy upcoming music talent.
Listen to Debbie Mack from 7 p.m. this week.
For a chance to win Carling Weekend Leeds Festival tickets and a Nokia 3250.
Plus, get to Jabez Clegg on June 13th.
Local bands and DJs and Nokia's rock up and play stage.
With a chance for any band to rock up and show off their talent.
Nokia.
Sharing your passion for music on Key 103.
Our new IKEA store opens in Ashton-under-Lyne in October and we're already assembling our team. We're looking for all kinds of people to work in sales, catering, customer service, warehouse and administration. In return, we offer a great working environment and flexible hours to suit your lifestyle. Putting a great team together isn't easy. So we're holding the IKEA job fair next week so we can all get to meet each other. We'll be at the new Oxford Park Sports Hall, Pottinger Street, Ashton-under-Lyne, from the 12th to the 17th of June, 10 until 8. That's the new Oxford Park Sports Hall, Pottinger Street, Ashton-under-Lyne. See you there.
You have 20 seconds on the City of Manchester starting now. There's an all-new TV channel that is totally focused on Manchester. What is that channel? Correct.
Hey, hang on.
You can now get regular in-depth news reports from Manchester on which channel?
Oh, I should know this.
Correct. Code 13 is a rugby league action fest on which channel?
Oh, now you're asking.
Correct. You have scored maximum points.
Channel M is the all-new TV station for Manchester with more news, more sport, more entertainment, more Manchester full stop. Channel M, now on Sky Guide 203, NTL 26 and free-to-air frequency 39.
This is the story's self-titled album. Wonderful songs and instinctively beautiful harmonies. An incredibly accomplished debut album. Includes the singles Be By Your Side and Cinnamon.
A band with live performances not to be missed. Catch the Stories on the road with Elton John this summer. The Stories album is a perfectly polished gem. It's out now.
The James H. Reid phone-in on Key 103. Call now on 0161 288 0103.
Thank you. I've got a text message here about someone who's done 10 years in prison. That might be interesting to hear, but it's appalling on a text, you see. And before you start moaning, I didn't ask you to text, so don't dumb that. Don't come that business. I can't really make out what you're saying, mate. It's a phone-in, though. I just, you know, I'm not asking you to draw any conclusions from that. I'm just saying, phone-in. You've just heard it. We have jingles done. They're very expensive. Right. On the rubber band front, and I will point out to... I'll send a copy of the paragraph in the Act covering this to allowing or causing to... We're going to experiment with a CD player in a second, but on past record is not an illustrious one in this, is it?
No.
No. But might not have been a bad idea to forget this, but here we go. Right. I shall bring the paragraph in the Act to the attention of the gaffer of the post office or whatever it is, but. Well, you've no idea what you're doing, have you? You've got no idea at all.
No. What do you do?
What do you mean? What do you do? What do you do? Say it's nice. That normally answers everything.
Carry on.
What? Why have you switched my headphones off so now I can't hear myself?
No, I haven't.
Oh, yes, you have.
Have I?
Yes, you've put it on pre... Oh, there, I can hear myself again now. There we are. Months of training, a rigorous interview. And now...
What do I do?
And now, the next part of the programme is brought to you by someone wearing boxing gloves. Right, you do change.
Yeah.
And then you select... input.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yes.
Right, and then you change it using that, and...
Thank you.
Bob's your uncle. There we are, thank you. Don't worry. That's one of the skills I'm not actually required to have. Bloody hell, how did you do that? Because we can't do the rubber band spot without the appropriate... to set the mood, you know. Rubber band holds her trousers up.
That's what you use them for, isn't it?
She is only slender, isn't she?
Yeah.
Right, listen. There is, apparently there is one more. I can't believe this. In the whole history of popular music, there have only been three songs made on the subject of rubber bands.
Amazing. You think it'd be a lot more.
The Detroit Spinners. Kate Bush there, who I'm sure you recognised. And, Grandmaster Jamesy James. And, apparently Yellow. Those German, they're a bit round the bend. They've done one called Rubber Band Man, but I can't find that. Can't find it on the system.
We've done well to find those two, really.
Well, I didn't find that on the system. I found it down the back of the city. Anyway, listen. The latest in the rubber band stakes is as follows. And we will take a picture of the... will you take a picture of me ball later?
Yeah, sure.
Thanks. Now, we've got these from Spanner Swirly Flow.
Looking quite swollen, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And they're very angry. And I don't know how many there are.
But there we are. Can you, will you deal with those, please?
Yes, of course.
That's a collection of red rubber bands found by Spanner Swirly Flow. Thank you very much indeed. And also, hello, James. 12 bands found for your collection. Best wishes. Is that, I don't know, is that Bette Davis?
Let's have a look. Oh, I've no idea.
Okay, then. In Ermston, much obliged.
It could be Bert.
Bert Davis?
Or...
He's got Bert... Don't know. He's got Bert Davis eyes.
Right.
Yeah. And also... Oh, these stink. I must look at the health and safety because all these have actually spent some time on the pavement, haven't they?
Yeah.
And there may very well be a bit of Toxicara canis involved.
Lovely.
Anyway, dear James, I'm not sure if these count because I found them pretty much ankle deep in the yard round the back of the local Royal Mail parcel office.
Oh.
Did you? This is Stephen from Chorlton. I leave it to your sense of honour. Me, I'd shoot a fox if the fancy took me. Well...
We'll mix them in.
Well, yeah, no, I think these are legitimate because they are not. They have been caused or allowed to fall to the ground.
Yeah, true.
In an unauthorised and gravitational fashion. So, yeah, there we are.
Brilliant.
So.
I don't know if we'll fit them onto the ball because it's at breaking point.
No, you know, you'd be surprised. They're remarkably resilient.
Lovely.
Right. You're not lying for the, right. a couple of text messages as well. James, my mate, oh. Okay, what do you think? Kate Bush or Detroit Spinners? It's
text
up to
now.
You. Yeah. Yeah. Calls cost a pound and Fortnum's goes to charity.
Vote Kate or vote Detroit.
Me and her get the rest. James, my mate got fined £500. This is from someone who claims to be called Shagger Harder. So it was nice. It's nice to welcome. We are a very inclusive programme, so I'm not sure where your name comes from, sir, or possibly madam. My mate got fined £500 for throwing a carrier bag off a bench so that he could sit down.
Oh, so it wasn't his? So there was a carrier bag on a bench and he wandered over and probably flicked it off to sit down.
By the sound of things, yeah.
Yeah.
Right. I'm not sure how outraged I should be about that one. James, do you think we will ever travel in time? What are your theories? No, we won't. We weren't actually planning to play any East 17 just at the moment, or indeed any Elton John. And James, can you tell me more about Paul Hince, former City player? He is my great uncle. Right. Oh, I could tell you a lot about him. But let me contact Paul Hince first and see whether he's going to offer me more to keep quiet.
Hmm.
Right. Paul Hince is my great uncle. I don't really know him. I'm pretty sure he scored a hat trick on his debut, but he was then shit. Well, that, actually, I don't think Paul would disagree with that by his own admission. I think he scored. Let me see now. I'll ring him if you want. I'll tell him we had this inquiry. I'll tell him it was from his great uncle, and he can come round from his great nephew, and he can come round and in person. Face to face.
Surprise, surprise, couldn't we?
Yeah, give you a good hiding. I think he scored two on his debut. I think he scored two against West Brom on his debut. What am I doing?
No, I know, you're not.
What am I talking about?
Yeah, well, stop it.
Okay, sorry.
Quickly. Do you want me to read out some emails?
Yes, please.
Divert attention away.
Yeah.
Mark in Wigan says, hi, James. This thing about the taser guns. If you got Jackie a taser for her birthday, she could use it in the studio and make your show much more lively. Well, it'd be shocking, wouldn't it?
Well, like, just to keep me alert. Send 500 volts up me tockers every so often.
Hey, Wiggy, you banned local celebs, you banned the World Cup, and you're about to ban Jackie's birthday, I think. Why are you trying to... Sorry, it's late. It's the last one of the week. Why are you trying to win the biggest misery on the planet award? It's supposed to be a happy occasion, you misery. Try and smile, it won't crack your face. Hey, miserable, says Linda. How come you parted with a piece of fudge for Jackie? Did she have to get you in an arm lock to make you hand it over? Why don't you try and redeem the shambles and sing happy birthday to her? You don't know the words, do you?
No, I don't, actually. How does it go?
David Swinton says, hi, James, I was
That's
late...
very good, that. He doesn't know the words to happy birthday. That's a gag in the making, that. I'm going to steal
write
that.
Write it down.
Yeah. He doesn't know the words to happy birthday.
I was late tuning in tonight. May I ask, is Jackie not in? I thought you might be doing something special with it being a birthday. No, Dave, no, I just got a piece of fudge. I didn't even get a card. Jane in Salford says, hello, James, all this chat about pigeons and knives is all very nice, but where's Jackie? Can you not get her in? When are you going to sing happy birthday to her? You should have done that first.
Is it me? Or...
Honestly, these are the emails in massive, you know, support of...
those are the only emails we've got.
So far, yeah. Last time I checked,
right, we've been talking about the use of force against intruders on your property.
Yeah.
We've been talking about the criminal justice system.
Uh-huh.
We've been talking about the undermining of authority in schools.
Yeah.
By panels of unelected people who can overturn decisions by the head teacher.
Yeah.
And those are the emails we've had.
Yeah, what can I say? It's
every single one of which mentions your birthday.
Yeah.
Oh, but one did mention a taser in passing.
Yeah, it did, yeah.
I like tasers, me. By the way, happy birthday, Jackie.
These are the ones that are coming in. This is what people are saying.
You
need to listen to them, rather than just dismissing them.
We can find out, you know. I know I have to look in the computer and see whether you're telling me the truth.
You can if you want.
Okay. Right then. The person who does a lot of voiceovers on Key 103 sounds like a combo of Lee Marvin, Jamie Oliver.
Jamie Oliver?
Jamie Oliver.
Jamie Oliver. Jamie Oliver.
Ooh. And the bloke who does the narrative for the Hovis ad. Is that Joe Gladwin?
He was a great voiceover artist.
Thank you. Right, that's from Minjita. Okay.
It's descending now, isn't it?
What?
Into chaos.
It's, well, towards the end of the week, I do feel that we can, you know, extend a bit of an open invitation. I'm just going to find out the words to that Kate Bush song, actually, because I'd like to know more about it.
I thought you were going to say happy birthday, then.
Eh?
Nothing.
Too late now, you'll have to wait while the next one.
Yeah.
Okay. Right, 26 minutes past midnight on Key 103. James H. Reeve here, and what else was there we want to... yeah, what about this? If you live in Lower Broughton, have you received a letter telling you... In fact, we've got the wording here, haven't we?
Careful when you use... You know...
Not to enjoy yourself, but if... in the event of, you know... not to celebrate too much, because a lot of people have had letters from the council... Telling them, I'll tell you why. In fact, I'll read out to you the exact wording, so you can tell me how you feel about this. 0161 288 0103 on that or any other matter. That will put you on the biggest phone in the Northwest. Key 103.
Key 103.
I am in Sayers Bakery on Cross Street in Manchester.
I want you to walk into the shop that you've chosen now.
I'm walking.
And buy the entire stock.
Right, I'm walking in. How much would it be just to have that everything in the shop? Everything. Literally, I'd like everything in the shop. It will cost it, but I've got some money. She's not sure.
Oh, she's not sure.
Steve Pegg's Weekend Breakfast, Saturday and Sunday from 9. Only on Key 103.
So, will you pick sexy Salzburg, birthplace of Mozart and setting for the Sound of Music? Or would you rather Bratislava? She's a 24-hour city, but will you keep up? Or will you have a crack at Krakow? Beautiful by day, but what a sight by night. The choice is yours.
With Sky Europe Airlines, the choice is even easier. Just £25 each way, including taxes, can get you a date with these European cities, thanks to Central Europe's largest low-cost airline. Just visit skyeurope.com. Skyeurope.com. More Europe to discover. Terms and conditions apply.
This is the story, self-titled album, wonderful songs, and a
distinctively beautiful harmonies. An incredibly accomplished debut album. Includes the singles Be By Your Side and Cinema. With live performances not to be missed. Catch the Stories on the road with Elton John this summer. The Stories album is a perfectly polished gem. It's out now.
Helen, do you want
a baby?
No, do you want
a baby?
No, Helen, do you want
No, I want a baby.
No, do you want
I want a baby.
A cup of tea. Do you want a cup of tea?
Yes, please, and a biscuit.
Good.
And a baby.
Feeling broody? It's time to go on the pill. Sinatogen Pronatal is a multivitamin and mineral supplement with folic acid that's scientifically proven to ensure you get the important vitamins and minerals you may need before and during your pregnancy. Sinatogen Pronatal.
The James H. Reid phone-in on Key 103.
I thank you.
Call now on 0161 288 0103.
Yes, it's really funny. I can't find it now. What have I done with it? Here we are. I'm sorry, this is very poor. Where is it? Where's page one of this?
Of what?
The thing about not getting excited if the, over the... Sorry, we're just having a bit of a filing malfunction here. There it is, you idiot. housing chiefs, listen, I'm sorry, I'm reading this. I will not try to disguise the fact. I am reading this. And therefore, it's in that style. Killjoy, housing chiefs. Killjoy, again, another word that is only ever used when writing news stories, isn't it?
Yeah.
Killjoys have warned revellers. Killjoy housing chiefs have told football mad council tenants not to cheer England too loudly during the World Cup. Residents in Salford were astonished. Said Mrs. Edith Scrott of Lower Broughton said, I were astonished, me. Residents in Salford were astonished to receive the letters warning them to keep the noise down while watching the tournament on TV. Officials say the request has been made because not everyone is a football fan. Do you know, it's true, and that's not the first time I've heard that pointed out this week. Yeah. And anyone who disturbs the peace could be in breach of their tenancy agreement. Armchair fans have slammed. I just slammed it, me. I read it and I slammed it. They have slammed the warnings as outrageous.
I think it's outrageous.
They never said outrageous. It's out, bang out of order.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. And they said they now fear they could be evicted just for backing their countrymen in Germany. The letters, you can look this up if you want.
Backing them doing what? I don't understand what's going on.
Well, all right, let's just cut to the chase here. It means getting drunk and shouting your head off in the small hours of the morning.
Oh, now I understand.
Right. But that's what being, you know, football's all about anyway.
Is it?
It seems.
Oh.
Well, you wouldn't know because you're a woman.
Hmm.
The letters were distributed to residents in Huffwalk, Lower Broughton, by New Prospect Housing, the company which runs Salford's council houses. Oh, right. Oh, so we've got a private firm running the council houses. Oh,
yeah.
That'll be going like clockwork, won't it? Yeah. Last week, the New Prospect Housing banned its drivers from flying England flags. Yeah, we said that.
They've done that loads, though, haven't they, over the last few years? With Euro 2006 and the last World Cup, they did it.
Yeah, but I was talking about Lower Broughton.
I'm just saying.
Yeah, I know you're just saying.
It's been done before.
Yeah.
Stop being so argumentative.
Anyway, the letter says, I would like to ask that if you are a football fan or are following the World Cup competition, that should your team win... Should your team win any matches, that you show consideration towards neighbours and the local community, as not everyone is a football fan and not everyone will be wanting to celebrate or be disturbed by ongoing celebrations.
That's true.
Well, I suppose when you put it that way, yeah, I mean, obviously, don't be ridiculous, but I would have thought that it's a rather different occasion. It's the one time when I think, well, apart from the Ashes last summer, obviously, but broadly speaking, people who
don't take much notice the rest of the time. We'll give it the time of day. Wasn't something like 40% of the people who watched our last floundering, blundering attempts to win the World Cup? 40% of them were women, I think, weren't they?
Is that right?
I think it was 40, or might even have been 45%.
Oof.
Let's ask Helen in Bury. She knows all about that sort of thing. Hello, Helen.
Hello, Jim.
Hello. Are you a football fan? Because there is a little bit of a discussion going on in the studio.
Right.
And in the offices, for that matter.
Right.
Yeah. Are you interested in football at all?
I can be.
Are you going to be following the World Cup?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you watching Saturday's game?
Well, I'll be in Sorrento.
Oh.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
Are you?
Does that mean you're not allowed to speak to anybody?
But what they do out there, they put the televisions in the back streets, and they all sit and watch televisions.
Who do? The,
The Italians.
The Italians? Do
so
they
you
really?
Get Italian yeah. At the same time.
Mm?
Brilliant.
Well, yeah. They do that. They do that in Bury, don't they? Only they tend to throw them off the balcony there.
Balconies?
Yeah. In the flats, you know.
Oh right. Yeah.
Okay. Usually on the rent man, on the bloke from New Prospect Housing.
I'm from Prospect.
Oh, I see. Sorry. Ringley.
It'd be absolutely brilliant.
They are. Well, there was an occasion, you know, when City were playing at this capacity, this lockout game at Edgeley Park.
Yeah.
A county sent us about 1,500 tickets or something.
Right.
So they said, well, what we'll do is, and you want to listen to this, you Jackie, because this is what happens when you're in the big league.
Oh, I'm listening hard.
They said, what we'll do is we'll relay the game live. Back. This was still at Main Road. Back to Main Road. And you can watch it. Right, and people paid to go to Main Road and watch the satellite transmission from Edgeley Park.
No, they did!
They did! I went!
That makes you even worse.
Right? I just thought it was brilliant. So, this is absolutely true. Right, so the match has been beamed, and there was about, I think it was about 800 people. all sat in this bar.
They did that at Old Trafford a few times, didn't they? Put a big screen up and
yeah,
played, yeah.
It was a rather different thing, though. So we thought, all right, well, the big screen, you know, the truck will be backing in the big trailer with the huge screen on it shortly. You know, and it'll be, obviously, a team of fitters will be rigging it up. And what actually happened was, a bloke with, you know, like one of those hostess trolleys?
Mm.
Are you listening, Helen?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, like those brass effect trolleys? You should have one in the hall sometimes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. With a television on it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. My granddad's still got one of
those. A portable one.
Television.
Yeah.
No, with a
A trolley. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, with a telly on it, pushed it out onto the pitch. I think it had come out of Bernard Holford's back bedroom, his secretary.
Mm.
You know, so that was it.
Right.
Yeah. Anyway, go on. Why did that happen?
Don't know.
Yeah. No. And the thing is, when you're doing that, because you're in a football ground, and you're watching it, people would shout, "Man on!" Honestly.
Hey. I'll be shouting "Man over the road" tomorrow.
Why? Are you going to try and get a man on during the holidays, Helen?
Hopefully.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Well, the Italians, will be all over you, Helen.
Hey, it's the first holiday I've had in 6 years, so I'm going to right enjoy myself.
Right. Will you be large? Is it called? Will you be having it large?
Hopefully.
Right. Helen?
A large pint.
Right.
You drink pints?
Yeah.
And you like football?
Yeah.
Hmm. You sure your name's Helen?
Yeah.
Something dodgy
I'm here. A woman.
And
I'm late to enjoying life at the moment.
How long are you going for?
Just a week.
Very nice.
Hang on. Why have you not been on holiday? You're a skint member.
Yeah.
Brassic.
I was a skint member, right. But I've had a slight windfall.
Lottery?
Yeah.
Really?
No, you haven't.
Have you won the lottery?
Yeah.
Serious?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you know, I always find Barry accent very attractive, Helen.
Oh, I love the black puddings.
How many numbers did you get?
Six.
Give over.
Six.
Six numbers?
Did you?
Yes.
When was this?
It was about a fortnight ago.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Oh, in that case...
I've booked one or two holidays.
I bet you have. Hey.
Yeah. I'm going to, Ibiza.
Yeah.
And I'm going to the Norwegian fjords.
Yes.
And then I'm going to the Caribbean.
God blimey, Charlie.
Well done, you. Do you play it every week?
Yes.
How long have you been playing it for?
How many years has it been going?
So since it began, you've been playing it every week?
12 years.
12 years?
12 years, 1994 yeah. It started, didn't it? Yeah.
And the big question is, how much did you win?
I'm not letting you know.
Oh, you put an extra no
publicity.
Just
security reasons.
Right. What, social security reasons?
It was just one or two pennies.
Listen. Let me tell you a story, Alan. Let me tell you a story.
All right.
It's a salutary tale, this.
This is a sob story.
Do you know what a salutary tale is?
Go on.
Okay. Well, I say yes or no.
Go on.
Do you know what a salutary tale is?
Yeah.
Okay, right. Well, this is one. Right. But the fella who... He goes to the... takes his ticket in. Blimey, says... You know, like you go to the news agents, don't you? So you just put those through for us. And she says, this is a big one, this. He says, oh, give us that. Oh, blimey. So, he sends it off. Anyway, Camelot get hold of him. And they said, we'd like you to come for a press conference and everything. So, right, so they've got the check. So he says, how much is it? He says, £6 million. £6 million, he says, yeah. He says, right, oh, brilliant. So, they come to the, come to a hotel in Manchester. This is a true story, this.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, right, well, he said, hey, Mr. Earnshaw. He said, here's your cheque for £6 million. Now, tell me something, will this change your life? He says, I would have thought so. He said, well, what do you do at the moment? He says, well, you know, Morrison's, I work in, in the gents' toilets in there. I clean it out and just like keep it straight. Oh, I said, right. He says, so what are you going to do then? He says, well, I was thinking of like a few cruises, nice big house, move away from here. Several holidays, nice holidays. He said, and what does your wife do? He said, well, she works at Morrison's in the ladies' toilets. And, you know, she doesn't like mops around and keeps it straight in there. And, he said, and do you think she'll enjoy the cruises and the new house? He says, well, she won the lottery, you know.
That's terrible.
I mean, I'm just saying,
because that's what it can do to people, you know what I mean?
Yeah. I've got a terrible problem, though.
Oh, you've got a problem, yes. Well, we can help with anything like that, Ellen.
Mm. How to spend it?
Yeah. I don't know where to go on holiday next year.
Well, where would I like to go? It is a snag, that, isn't it?
I'd like to do a trip around America.
Yeah, it's a bit of a problem.
Mm.
I don't fancy America.
Australia?
New Zealand.
Problem solved, yeah.
Right, we'll go to New Zealand next year, then.
See, the trouble is, women can be very difficult to please.
Yeah.
Because my mate, he went home and he said, look, I said, I've sorted the holidays out. He said, we're going on a world cruise. And his wife said, oh, can't we go somewhere else? You know what I mean? There's no... It's just being awkward, that, isn't it?
Well, this cruise that I've booked, you know, to Caribbean,
yeah.
I've got an outside cabin with a balcony.
Oh, that's lovely. Home from home, isn't it?
I don't know if you've heard how much student debt I'm in, Helen.
Sorry?
You know, I've mentioned it a while ago, how much student debt I've got.
What she's saying is, don't forget your old friends, will you? You know what I mean?
No, I won't do that.
No.
That's nice, thank you.
No.
Don't go telling everyone.
We remember you when you had nothing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, that wasn't quite... I didn't know. What did I mean to say then?
When you were when she was, you know, Helen in Bury. Yeah.
The taxi's picking me up in 2 hours.
Is it? I thought that might be the case.
Mm.
Why, is your weekend leave? Oh, no, what, to take you to the airport?
Yeah.
Yeah, right, lovely. So, where, you're going to,
I'm going to Sorrento.
Sorrento,
today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What made you choose Italy?
I love it.
That's good enough.
I've been there loads of times.
Yes.
And I really enjoy it.
Right.
The people that are so friendly, it's just wonderful.
Yes, they noted, yeah, for, in fact, they will actually fight for whoever just comes along next, won't they? They never fall out with anybody.
Careful of any gold diggers.
Do you like Italian food?
Oh, I do.
What do you have? What's your favourite?
I love pasta. Spaghetti bolognese.
Oh, hey, that's from, that's exotic, isn't it?
Mm.
See, now, I'll just give you a bit of a hint. Right, I made a bit of a fool of myself.
Oh,
I don't mind
God.
Admitting it.
Go on.
Well, the first time I went to an Italian restaurant.
Yeah.
It was all very new at the time, you know what I mean?
Mm.
And I was amazed to see, when I saw all that spaghetti, I thought that there must have been a massive tin of open air. But this was all like proper stuff.
Mm.
And I said, you know, like, when you're on unfamiliar territory, you don't like to show yourself up. So you try and act a bit nonchalant, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So I said, he comes up and he says, I looked at the menu and I said, I'll have the Pagione, please. And he said, that's page one, so. So I had to just, like, laugh it off, you know what I mean?
As you did. Yeah, you would, yeah.
I'll tell you something else, though, lasagna.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, hey, well, I'll tell you what, this is like Floyd, isn't it? This is like,
perfect
you are the...
holiday.
Yeah, you are the Keith Floyd of Spring Street, Alan.
Do you like pizza?
I do.
That's another Italian
ham, mushroom and pepperoni.
Yeah.
Nice and crispy.
Yeah. Oh, you can have you had the what's it, the King Wenceslas pizza?
Go on.
Have you not had that? It's a special pizza you have on Christmas, well, Boxing Day, strictly speaking.
Alright.
Yeah.
Go on.
It's named after King Wenceslas.
Yeah.
Because it's deep pan, crisp and even. Laugh.
James, you get worse.
Talk about laugh. They said it couldn't be done, but I got worse. I showed them.
Okie dokie.
Right, well, have a nice time in Sorrento. Take me back there. And watch out, apparently there's a lot of seagulls there, I've been told. So watch out for them.
No,
yeah,
there
yeah.
isn't a lot of seagulls.
No, there is, there's a song about it.
Oh, go on.
There is! There's a song called Seagulls Over Sorrento.
Yeah. I'm going, because you get worse.
I was
speaking to you both.
I don't think you were supposed to be speaking to us both, but there. Right, Right, well, have a nice time then.
But next time I go, I'll take you with me.
Oh, would you do? That would be lovely.
Yeah.
Yes, I'd be prepared to, yeah?
Yes, you wish to partake.
Oh, in exchange for a... Yeah, obviously, you'd have to keep me in the manner, the style to which I'm accustomed.
Of course.
Yeah, well, that'd be all right then.
As long as you drink pints.
Yes, I will. I will. Thank you very much indeed. I'm just getting, I'm just thinking this is a bit like when Troy McClure married Selma's. Was it Selma or Patty? Anyway, I've got the picture.
Yeah. Well, I shall get a few pints of Italian lager down my neck.
Yes, indeed. And you just show them, Ellen, that they can forget all about this Italian sophistication when you get down there. You get some pints of lager down your neck and some spaghetti bolognese, and you show them that we can be just as chic and stylish as they can.
Oh, yeah. I shall be sophisticated.
Yeah, I would say so.
Mm.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Don't let out a dirty big Raquel when you've, you know, after the lager, because that lets the side down a bit, doesn't it?
No,
yeah.
No. Okay. I'll keep myself sophisticated.
Yes, I should.
Have a good time.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yes, arrivederci.
And I shall speak to you soon.
Okay. Or as the Italians say, al forno.
Ah.
Okay. Oh, right, that's some sort of strange strangled noise she made there, wasn't it? Yeah. Did you just see somebody coming, climbing through the window? Ah. Right. Oh, 10 to 1, heavens above. We'll be able to squeeze in. This isn't him, is it?
It is.
Oh,
God. Yeah.
We'll be able to squeeze... we'd like to leave you with one lingering image of the broadcast to cling on to, and we'll do that in a second. 10 minutes to 1 now.
Key 103.
I am in Sayers Bakery on Cross Street in Manchester.
I want you to walk into the shop that you've chosen.
Okay,
now.
I'm walking.
And buy the entire stock.
Right, I'm walking in. How much would it be just to have that everything in the shop? Everything. Literally, I'd like everything in the shop. It will cost it, but I've got some money. She's not sure.
She's not sure.
Steve Pegg's Weekend Breakfast, Saturday and Sunday from 9. Only on Key 103.
This is the story's self-titled album. Wonderful songs and instinctively beautiful harmonies. An incredibly accomplished debut album. Includes the singles Be By Your Side and Cinema.
And with live performances not to be missed. Catch the Stories on the road with Elton John this summer. The Stories album is a perfectly polished gem. It's out now.
G'day, mate. G'day, Bruce.
Hey.
Yeah, mate. My girlfriend just got this bonza deal on her car insurance from Sheila's Wheels.
Oh, that's unbelievable.
Straight up, Sheila's Wheels car insurance for women.
No, I mean, it's unbelievable you've got a girlfriend.
A deal, girls, call 0800 085 6919 or visit SheilasWheels.com. Terms and conditions apply.
Oh, Robert, could you come and give me a hand in the bedroom? I'm just trying on this new maid's outfit, but it seems a little tight. Robert?
Pro Plus. It beats nodding off.
Relieves temporary tiredness, contains caffeine, always read the label.
Finger.
Yes, brain?
Time to put feet through their paces in one of our little back garden kickabouts. Together, we body parts are a very fine team, you know. We line the ball up, we slam it into the fence, we line the ball...
Brain? Why is bottom on the ground?
Skybox Office. All you need is a brain and a finger. This week in Goal, a young Mexican boy escapes from a humdrum life in Los Angeles for the trials and temptations that face a professional footballer in Newcastle. Oh, pull the other one. Anyway, there's some bloke called Beckham in it as well. Sky Digital subscribers only. Sky Box Office terms apply.
Brain?
Yes, finger.
Are all referees blind?
1,400 text messages.
And 100 minutes per month.
On any Orange Pay monthly mobile phone. When you join the Dolphin £30 package in June.
Sounds good, doesn't it?
So for 1,400 texts and 100 minutes per month on a Dolphin £30 package, visit your local Orange shop this weekend. Subject to an 18-month contract, 1,400 texts for 6 months and 1,200 texts for 12 months ends 30th of June 2006. Terms apply.
The brand new album from Key, out Monday.
The James H. Reeve phone-in on Key 103.
It's Raquel time.
Call now on 0161 288 0103.
Tony in Wigan.
No, Southport, James. I can't believe I've just been escorted off a train by the police.
Just a moment. Hasn't something like this happened to you before?
No, I've never meant. No, I've always spoke to you from home, James. I was travelling from Manchester, to Wigan on the train.
Yes.
I fell asleep and woke up in Southport. Yeah.
Yeah. If you say so. Yes.
Yeah, that's where I am now. Stood here freezing. I can't even listen to you, James. And then the guard on the train, because I was asleep, got policed to march me off. And I said, the train was going back private. I said, can I not stay on the train and go back private? And the police said to me, no, go and sleep on the beach. They were really nasty to me. They've escorted me off the platform.
Nasty police officers?
Nasty police officers.
Oh, pull the other one.
Honestly, you dragged me off there, and all I'd done is, the only crime I committed was falling asleep on the train.
Listen, I'll tell you something, and I know this is no help to you, but in London, about 5 or 6 years ago, a nun was arrested, fell asleep on a bus, and went past a stop.
Oh, yeah, possibly, yeah. It's getting me the cold now. The temperature's dropping like a stone here. All I've got on is a thin shirt. I've no clothes with me. I've got a bag of shopping, and another bag. I've got two bags of shopping here, mate.
I'm going nowhere. Listen, I'm not coming to pick you up. You have to make your own arrangements, but.
No, James, I'm not going to say that. I'm just saying the ridiculous treatment I've got off Northern Trains tonight is unbelievable. There is no train now back till half past six in the morning.
Right, and they wouldn't let you stay on the train?
No, and he was going back private, yeah.
Where was the train going back to?
To Wigan. It parks up in Wigan for the night.
Well, I tell you, seriously... You want to play hell about this? I mean, at least let's go through the motions, right? Let's get in touch with them and explain what happened. Did the driver wake you up?
One of the guards. I fell asleep on the train. I woke up in Southport.
Yeah.
I said, sorry, mate, I fell asleep on the train. I'm supposed to get it off at Wigan.
And? Come on, try and tell a bloody story. Try and make it a flowing narrative.
Yeah, then two policemen turned up, saying you fell asleep off the train, you have to get sorted. I was begging them to take me back to Wigan, because they were going back private, James.
Yes, I know. Did the guard call the police?
Yeah.
Right, so they didn't just turn up.
The guard has called the police, because I fell asleep on the train.
Yeah, why? It's not a crime.
I know, exactly. That's what I'm really annoyed about. It's not... there must be hundreds of people falling asleep on trains all over the country.
Well, perhaps not hundreds, but, it has been known to happen.
Yeah, I'm really annoyed. And they've dumped me. All I've got on is a thin shirt and no jacket and nothing. Because it's been a hot day, obviously, James.
Yes.
And
yes,
they've been
yes.
out, and the temperature's dropping like a stone, and I'm feeling cold, and I'm stuck in Southport.
Right.
Now, obviously, nobody can do nothing about that, but I found Northern should have thought about that. It's going to be cold by 5 o'clock in the morning.
I mean, one way round it, and I wouldn't suggest this or recommend it for a moment, but it's like to go into Lord Street and put a shop window in, because,
That's it, oh, man. Yeah. That's happened, yeah.
Yeah, but that is extreme, and obviously we couldn't possibly condone or encourage that sort of behaviour.
Yeah, obviously, I don't even know where Lord Street is.
Well, I'll tell you what, we'll ask a policeman.
Oh, no, they'd probably beat me up on the way around. They're not very nice police officers.
Well, let these words... You remember these words now. My dad said, this was said to him in the Western Desert, which I suppose at Southport, it's not dissimilar. The words which his battery sergeant major said to him were, not my problem, pal. So there we are. So that's Tony, live from Southport. And what will happen to him? Tune in on Tuesday night. Why did I say Tuesday? Because I wish I wasn't here on Sunday, but I am. I'll tell you what, there's an hour non-stop music. Is that right with you?